Good morning. So I'll tell you the plan of the approach which I will follow in the first 2 minutes, and then we'll go ahead. Okay. So how are the questions asked? Last year question paper, if you see, and before last year, maybe 2014-15, there is some change with respect to trend. So what is the change which we find with respect to the trend is? They started asking, if you see last year question papers, there was a question on opportunity cost. I don't know how many of you have seen the question paper. Okay, there was a question on opportunity cost. Okay, there was a question on treasury bills, T-bills, okay. And there were several easy questions also, okay. And there was a question on capital adequacy ratio, okay. So that means earlier we did not find such questions. That means, like, for example, earlier we had questions like if repo rate increases, what will happen to money supply, what will happen to inflation, such easy questions. Suppose let's say there are 18 questions from economy, 18 to 20. So almost generally 10 questions are generally easy. That is something doable. Three are factual, 3 to 4, okay. Another 4, 3 to 4 are dicey. Dicey means basically we do not know what the answer is. So this is how the pattern was, okay. So what I will be trying to do is, I have divided, maybe today we will cover areas related to banking, monetary policy, current affairs related to banking, monetary policy or Basel norms, whatever is there in news, okay. And then you have something called as fiscal policy. In fiscal policy, you have current affairs, okay. And you have financial markets, for example, treasury bills, exchange trade funds, okay. Or you have something like share swaps, okay. So that was in news, okay. So all these are some new things which are there. For example, Hindustan Unilever coming up with share swaps, okay. Or you have your Bombay Stock Exchange being given a status which has made IDRs more easy now. That, you know, what are IDRs? IDR is Indian Depository Receipts. Indian Depository Receipts, okay. Or there are cases like FDI in e-commerce, okay. Rules with respect to FDI in e-commerce, okay. So like this, you have many issues which are coming up in news. Or with respect to taxing also, there are some changes. So taxing, what were the changes which you see right now? What is your observation with respect to GST? What were the changes which you see with respect to GST? Any changes with respect to GST? No changes. With respect to GST, are there any changes in the last few months? Slabs is always there. What is the change? Okay. Okay, fine. One is this GST network, which was in news. Okay, so now it has become a government entity. Okay, earlier it was a non-government entity, isn't it? Now it is purely a government entity. 100% stake coming from government, isn't it? Okay. Then you have composition scheme. I think you would have heard of composition scheme. Okay, so composition scheme was only for? It was extended from 1 crore to 1.5. That is one thing. Second important aspect with respect to composition scheme is it is extended to service sector. Earlier it was not for service sector. It was only for manufacturing sectors, or it is only for micro, small and medium enterprises. Okay. Or you have a tax called as angel tax, which was in news. So I'll discuss the concept mainly, and then I will talk about the fact. Okay. So that is my approach. So today probably, and there is interim budget, okay. So interim budget, of course, I don't have so much of time that I'll discuss each and every point that has come up in the interim budget. But I will slash through very fast with respect to interim budget. What is important for prelims, only that I will stress. So when I'm doing the fiscal policy, some statistics and graphs from the economic survey, that is the last year economic survey, there are some trend-based questions that are coming. I will show you those with respect to fiscal policy, okay. So is this clear, ma'am? Okay. Then the third area is financial markets. So in financial markets, we will focus on some areas. For example, debenture redemption reserve. Heard of it? Debenture redemption reserve. Heard of Bharat 22? Okay. So Bharat 22 is basically a ETF. Okay. And foreign portfolio investments can currently invest in treasury bills. This is a new reform. Earlier, foreign portfolio investments could not invest in T-bills. They could only push their money into government securities. security. So like this, this is my approach. So when I'm teaching you something, probably I will focus on concept, then subsequently fact. And if there are some areas where purely factual, I'll give you some bullet points. This is the approach. Okay, for example, there is amalgamation of RRBs. That means the question will come from RRBs. That means it is current affair, history of the current affair, rather than the current affair. That is important. History of the current affair rather than the current affair. For example, you have urban cooperative banks being changed into small finance banks. So that means the small finance bank concept is basically part of differentiated banking. So this differentiated banking, there can be a question. That means which committee recommended differentiated banking, etc. Which committee recommended differentiated banking? What is differentiated banking? No, I'll not ask questions. We don't have time. Don't worry. What is differentiated banking? What do you mean by differentiated banking? Nandish? Okay. I'll talk about it. Don't worry. Okay. So first, my writing is not that great, but okay, please manage. Okay, so liquidity related aspects, there are some current affairs in news. So what are the current affairs related to liquidity as such? These are the things which we will see first. Okay, so one is an aspect of RBI or Monetary Policy Committee working towards monetary transmission. Okay, so working towards monetary transmission. Okay, so Monetary Policy Committee working towards monetary transmission. Okay, so working towards monetary transmission. So what is monetary transmission? I think you all know that is basically the repo rate being reduced should also lead to reduction with respect to interest rates of the banks. Okay, so this is called as monetary transmission. So with respect to bringing in monetary transmission, what were the reforms they brought in? So one was earlier you had prime lending rate concept. I think you know it. Okay, so earlier we had prime lending rate concept. Okay, so prime lending rate is the interest rate offered by banks to its best customers or prime customers. Okay, then this prime lending rate concept was replaced by a rate called base rate in 2010. Okay, so base rate is the interest rate below which banks should not give loans. Base rate is the interest rate below which banks should not give loans. Okay, so there are several factors that are taken for calculating the base rate. For example, you have cost of funds for the bank. Okay, you have operating expenses. You have CRR costs. And you have the concept of profitability. Okay, so these are some of the factors that are considered for base rate calculation. Okay. Repo is one of the factor, obviously, because it is included in your cost of funds. Okay. So what is this cost of funds for the bank? Cost of funds is basically banks borrow money from RBI. When they are borrowing money from RBI, they have to pay repo, basically. Okay. Then they are taking deposits from public. They have to pay something called as what? Interest. When there are term deposits, the interest rates are going to be higher. Okay. So all this is cost of funds for the bank. Got this point, right? Cost of funds for the bank. Okay, so repo indirectly is reflected in your cost of funds, but there is no direct reflection of repo in the cost of funds. That is the problem. Are you able to follow? Okay. Operating expenses day to day, CRR costs, I am not explaining CRR, but you don't receive any interest on CRR. So whatever money which the banks are maintaining with RBI, there's no interest. Therefore, it's a cost for banks, isn't it? Okay. And then profitability obviously is an important factor. Okay. Now, even base rate did not lead to monetary transmission. Base rate mechanism did not lead to monetary transmission. Okay. Reasons being very simple. What are the reasons for base rate failing? Okay. One is banks increase with respect to NPAs on a consistent basis. If you observe from 2011 to 2015-16, NPAs have increased 3 times. Okay, so that is one thing. Second, there are issues with respect to double financial repression. Double financial repression is basically banks started having problems from the asset side as well as the liability side. Okay, so asset side as well as the liability side. Double financial repression. Okay, so if you have any problem, you can stop me somewhere. Okay, suppose you do not know double financial repression, you stop me. If you know, I'll go ahead. Are you getting this? Okay, so, right. Then you have the problem of FIN balance sheet syndrome. Okay, so corporate's balance sheet was affecting the bank's balance sheet, and bank's balance sheet was affecting the corporate's balance sheet. Okay, and the most important problem is with respect to a problem called infrastructure loans. Infrastructure loans. So infrastructure loans, basically there is a delay or there are issues with respect to asset liability mismatch. So banks say that all these factors we have problems, but just because you reduce repo rate does not mean our costing is going to reduce. Our cost is dependent on multiple factors. It is dependent on deposit rates. It is dependent on our profits. It is dependent on so many things. So just because RBI reduces repo does not mean our cost is going to significantly reduce and therefore we can reduce the interest rates. No power, ma. We'll see. Okay, so is this clear? Okay, asset liability mismatch. Hope you know all this. Okay, so infrastructure loans, etc. Infrastructure loans are dangerous. Okay, so in news is basically IL&FS crisis in current affairs. Okay, it's basically a NBFC, non-banking financial company. Is it a deposit-taking NBFC or non-deposit-taking NBFC? Non-deposit-taking NBFC. Non-deposit-taking NBFC. Okay, after IL&FS crisis, were there any changes which were suggested with respect to NBFCs? No changes. Any change? Any changes with respect to NBFC? Okay, fine. NBFC, do they maintain CRR and SLR? Generally, they do not maintain CRR and SLR. But one logic is, generally, they maintain something like 15% in the form of liquid assets. Okay, 15% of the total loan amount is maintained in the form of liquid assets. Liquid assets. Liquidity. Now, such restrictions were not applicable to government. But after IL&FS crisis, they have decided to extend the liquidity measures even to government-related NBFCs. This is one thing which you will remember. Okay, so I'll come to NBFCs later. But this is one extension which they have done recently with respect to non-banking financial companies. NBFCs do not accept something called as demand deposits. NBFCs do not accept demand deposits. NBFC's primary business is generally not agriculture nor industry. Their primary business is generally not agriculture, not industry. Is this clear? Okay. Risk with respect to deposit-taking NBFCs is higher or non-deposit-taking NBFCs is higher? Risk will be higher for which NBFC? Non-deposit-taking NBFC, there are no deposits. That means you have to raise money from different other sectors. And if this NBFC is going to collapse, then it will have a drastic impact on the other sectors also. Are you getting this point? Okay. And that is the reason NBFCs have to be regulated enough. In India, NBFCs are regulated by? Obviously, RBI. Is this clear? Okay. Fine. So I'll come to that. So now, base rate system was launched. Okay, but this base rate system did not lead to appropriate monetary transmission. And therefore, in 2016, there was a new system which they brought in for calculating base rate, which is called as marginal cost of funds lending rate. Marginal cost of funds lending rate. Okay, so earlier banks were taking cost of funds. Okay. But what RBI was telling the banks is, instead of taking cost of fund, you just take marginal cost. That means any marginal change with respect to your cost, if it is because of repo also, marginal change. That means what if your repo rate decreases, there is a slight marginal change with respect to your cost. That should get reflected in your calculation as part of MCLR. That is their logic. Okay, earlier with respect to base rate, it is average cost of funds. Average cost of funds is different from marginal cost. Marginal cost in economics means every additional cost. Additional cost. That means if repo is going to reduce, additional cost incurred by the bank is going to reduce. This change with respect to that additional cost should get reflected in your base rate calculation. Are you getting this point? No? Okay, fine. See, for MCLR, what are the factors that are taken? See, one is marginal cost of funds. Okay. Second is tenor premium. Okay. Third is you have the carrying cost of CRR. Okay. And fourth, you also have operating expenses. Operating expenses. Operating expenses is day-to-day activity for the bank. Okay, carrying cost of CRR is CRR costs for the bank. It's a cost. Tenor premium means with respect to term loans, banks have to be given higher interest. Obviously. Why? Because if banks are lending to infrastructure loans, okay, the chances of default is higher and the delay is higher, so banks have to be adequately incentivized based on the term of the loan. Earlier in base rate system, all the loans you are taking similar interest rate. But in MCLR, different interest rates for different loans. Why different interest rate for different loans? Long-term loans, the risk associated for the bank is higher, so banks have to get some premium. So that is called as tenor premium or term premium. Tenor premium or term premium. Is that clear? Okay. Now another important aspect is base rates were not calculated every month. Whenever banks felt like calculating, they calculated base rates. Whether it is 3 months, 6 months, 9 months, 12 months. So that means in February, if you see, there was a change with respect to repo rate from 6.25 to 6. In Feb, there was a change with respect to repo rate from 6.25 to 6. That will not get reflected in the base rate because every month you are not calculating the base rate. Probably March, April, May. Then in June, you are going to come up with the base rate calculation. That means the reduction in repo in Feb will not get directly reflected in March because you are not changing it every month. That is number one. Number two, there is no complete change with respect to cost of funds. There is only a change with respect to marginal cost because cost of funds is dependent on multiple factors for the bank. So marginal cost means additional change would have been there for the bank, but not the overall cost of funds. So banks used to say our cost of funds did not change because of your change with respect to repo. And therefore, it will not get reflected in our base rate calculation. But in marginal cost means some minor change is there, which should get reflected in your base rate calculation. So that is every month calculation is number one with respect to marginal cost or MCLR. Okay. Earlier base rate system, whenever they want, they started calculating. Second important thing is interest rate with respect to loans is not same for all the loans. For base rate, it was almost same. Here it is not same. Okay. Third important aspect is this is basically calculated based on marginal cost of funds. So marginal cost of funds is additional cost incurred by the banks. Is this clear? Okay. So additional cost incurred by the banks, and there is something like return on net assets. Of course, that you will not required for UPSC. Okay. So return on assets. Okay. So 92% weightage is given to marginal cost of funds. Okay. So this is the change. Now, though in 2016, this reform of MCLR was brought in, what is the problem? Most of the banks still started following base rate only. They did not change, number one. Number two, monthly changes were not there with respect to MCLR. Monthly, they did not come up with their base rate calculation using MCLR. That means what? The MCLR reforms also did not lead to appropriate monetary transmission. Is this clear? No appropriate monetary transmission in spite of coming up with MCLR. Okay. So now, is this clear, ma'am? Okay. Now, why is RBI or the Monetary Policy Committee currently, which we are talking about, is focused on increasing liquidity? Now, if you are observing the newspapers on a consistent basis, you will observe few changes. What are the changes which you observe? One change is you slowly find that there is rupee value appreciation that is happening. Earlier, 1 year it was rupee value fall. Now you observe that there is rupee value appreciation. There is increased inflow of FIIs presently, last two and a half months, increased inflow of FIIs, complete reversed trend with respect to what you have observed last 1.5 years. Are you getting this point? Okay. Third important aspect is already RBI has reduced repo, or Monetary Policy as Committee has reduced repo by 25 basis points. Okay. That is 6.25 to 6. But banks reduced it only by 10 basis points. Banks reduced it by only 10 basis points. That means what? There is no appropriate monetary transmission. Already, RBI has used its mechanisms of OMOs, already used for injecting liquidity. What is OMO? Open market operations. Okay, that means RBI already purchased government securities to inject liquidity. Already that has been done. All this has already been done, but the problem is injecting liquidity has become an issue. Virat, okay. Injecting liquidity has become an issue. So injecting liquidity has become an issue, and therefore, what are the other reforms which RBI has come up with in the recent past? So since injecting liquidity, why injecting liquidity is important? See, there is this deal discussion with respect to SR Steel, ArcelorMittal, heard of it, a steel deal. So once this deal is completely concluded, how many billion dollars are going to move into India? It is approximately another $6 billion that are going to move into India. So more dollars are going to move into India means it can further create problems with respect to rupee value appreciation. If rupee value is going to appreciate, that means we will have a problem with respect to our exports. Exports will become costly, and it will increase our imports, which can affect our domestic market. Okay. Now this is a period when all the corporates are making their advance tax payments. You know what are advance tax payments? If you are listening to Radio Mirchi also, if you want rebate or concession with respect to taxes, corporates are asked to make advance tax payments now. If corporates are making advance tax payments, what is going to happen? Money, liquid cash in the hands of the banks is going to decrease. Are you getting this point? Advance tax payment means what? From their bank account, they are paying it to the government. Means cash in the hands of the bank is going to reduce because of advance tax payments. Are you able to follow? Complete reverse trend which is observed right now is advance tax payment. One is that rupee value slowly 2.5% approximately it is appreciating instead of depreciation. There is this fluctuation which you find. Third, ArcelorMittal deal, more dollars can move into India. Approximately $6 billion will move into India. More dollars moving into India will appreciate the rupee. Appreciating the rupee means imports are going to become cheaper, which can affect the domestic market, and exports are going to become costly, or our exports will decrease. Understood. Okay. And therefore, to counter rupee value appreciation, number one, okay, and to inject liquidity in the hands of the bank, why they should inject liquidity? Because already advance tax payments. Second is during elections, cash in the banks is going to reduce. Don't ask me why. During elections, election period, no. One is advance tax payment. Second is election period. That is current. Election period, what will happen? Automatically, cash in the banks is going to reduce. Cash will move from the banks into people's hands. So injecting liquidity into the banks is very important. Understood. Therefore, in the process of injecting liquidity, okay, one reason for injecting liquidity that was stated is the estimation of fall of economic growth of India from 7.4% to 7.2%. That is the expectation. Second is inflation is already under limits. That is, our midterm inflation target, CPI, is below 4%, 3.3, 3.4. And therefore, now injecting liquidity is an issue. So injecting liquidity is very important, not only for growth, but also for all these reasons. Not only for growth, but all these reasons, injecting liquidity is important. I think understood. Okay. Now for injecting liquidity, already what are the instruments that are already used? One is repo used. Did not work out. Okay. Already came up with MCLRs with for monetary transmission, not up to the mark. And that is the reason. Now two things are in news. All that also is in news only. But RBI came up with two important measures which were not done earlier. One important measure which RBI has come up with is the first time it has come up with the logic of forex swaps. Praveen, current manake boyinda? Okay. Chettu kodutunnara? Correct mana class kappude kottali chettu. Sare kaani. Okay, so forex swaps. Okay. So forex swaps is one thing which they brought in. Okay. And second important aspect is facility to avail liquidity for LCR. These are the two current implementations of RBI. Okay. One is forex swap. Forex swap, how many billion dollars? $5 billion forex swap in news. This is one current affair. First time they are doing so important for exam, and it is pretty simple to understand. No difficulty. Second is facility to avail liquidity for liquidity coverage ratio. Facility to avail liquidity for liquidity coverage ratio. This is one more current affair which is in news. Third is RBI has postponed the capital conservation buffer. RBI has postponed the capital conservation buffer requirements under Basel III. I'll explain what it is slowly. Basel III from 2019 to 2020. This is the change. Capital conservation buffer requirements have been postponed from 2019 to 2020. I think in your magazines you would have read capital conservation buffer. Okay. So already. I will explain the concept, what is the purpose of that buffer, etc. So before I explain, now forex swap is pretty simple. It is easy to understand. So let me first explain forex swap. Okay. So what happens in forex swap? That means here you have RBI, you have banks. Okay. RBI is buying dollars from banks. Simple. RBI is buying forex from banks. It is buying forex from banks. Okay. How much? $5 billion. And it is going to give banks what? Obviously, rupees. It is injecting liquidity. It is injecting liquidity. With a agreement that after 3 years, banks have to again repurchase these dollars or forex. This is called as forex swap. After 3 years, again, banks have to repurchase these dollars. But presently, the focus of forex swap is what? Injecting liquidity. Why injecting liquidity? I've talked about all that. Rupee value, advanced election, no cash, ASR, ArcelorMittal deal, growth issues. All these are reasons, of course, more important for mains. Is this clear? Okay. So now RBI is buying dollars, giving them what? Rupees. Repurchase. Banks have to purchase it back again. After 3 years. This is forex swap. No tension, forex swap. Okay. But some knowledge is required for understanding the other two. Okay. So that is capital conservation buffer as well as LCR, liquidity coverage ratio. Anybody, what is this LCR? Okay, fine. I'll explain. Okay, so now one important aspect is this concept of Basel III, which you should know. Only if you know Basel III, there are, you can understand those concepts. Okay, so Bessel norms are given by BIS. What is BIS? Bank for? What is this BIS? Board of? No. Bank of International Settlements. Bank of International Settlements, BIS. It is something like your Bank of Reserve Banks. As Reserve Bank is for our banks, okay, it is the head of all other reserve banks in the country. Why? Because uniform norms have to be followed across all the countries. Since uniform norms have to be followed across all the countries, you need some norm. Bessel is a norm. Norm means it is not compulsory. It is not binding. If you want to follow, you can follow. If you don't want to follow, you need not follow. But India, you know, no? India follows more than what is required. But it is a norm. Norm means you may follow, you may not follow. Got this point right? Now, already there was Bessel 1. Okay. You had Bessel 2. Then why is it that you have come up with Bessel 3? Obviously, that means the other two are hopeless or useless. Or there would have been some problems earlier. That is the reason, isn't it? Okay. So, India adopted Bessel 1 in 1999. Bessel 1. Okay. India adopted Bessel 2 norms in 2009. Okay. And Bessel 3, we have to implement it completely by 2019. Okay. Now, Bank of International Settlements was set up basically in 1930s. Obviously, 1930s because they wanted to handle the problem of Great Depression. And therefore, they started giving some guidelines. Okay. Now, 1999, Bessel 1, there are, for a bank, there are different types of risks associated with the bank. Remember this. So, one risk which is associated for the bank, you call it as the credit risk. Most dangerous form of risk. That means you are giving loan, the probability of repayment. That is credit risk. Fan ostadu kada mellagai idu pothadu. Okay, so one is credit risk. Center fan raavali naaku telusu. Middle fan ostadu anni middle lo ostayi. Okay, adu raada oppo. ఓకే సర్లే ఓకే సరే ఓకే వన్ ఇస్ క్రెడిట్ రిస్క్ సెకండ్ ఇస్ యూ హ్యావ్ ఆపరేషనల్ రిస్క్ దట్ మీన్స్ వాట్ డే టు డే యాక్టివిటీస్ దెర్ ఇస్ రిస్క్ సపోజ్ బ్యాంక్ ఫైర్ దెర్ ఇస్ అ బాంబ్ బ్లాస్ట్ ఎనీథింగ్ కెన్ హ్యాపెన్ నో ఓకే సో దట్ ఈస్ కాల్డ్ ఇస్ ఆపరేషనల్ రిస్క్ ఓకే సో థర్డ్ యూ హ్యావ్ వాట్ రిస్క్ You have a risk called as market risk. So when I'm talking about risk associated, there are three types of risks. Market risk means dependent on market conditions. It can be because of increase with respect to interest rates. It can be because of fluctuations with respect to foreign investments, etc. It can be because of fall with respect to rupee value. It is purely market. Okay, so there are three types of risk which have to be taken into consideration when lending is done. Is this clear? Okay. But Bessel 1 only takes into consideration aspects of credit risk. It did not take into consideration operational and market risk. Okay. So Bessel 2 focused on all the three types of risks. Bessel 2 focused on all the three types of risks. Okay. But since though there is Bessel 2, there was subprime crisis 2007-8. Okay, India adopted 2009, but Bessel norms are already there. But still, there was subprime crisis indicating that Bessel was not sufficient in terms of handling the financial crisis that was there in US. That is the meaning. Okay, so therefore, more stringent norms were pushed as part of Bessel 3. Bessel 3 also considered all the three types of risks. Okay. But more stringent norms were pushed in. Okay. So, with respect to risks, especially an aspect called as capital adequacy ratio, handling risk-related aspects, it is capital adequacy ratio that is taken into consideration. Okay. So, capital adequacy ratio calculation in Basel 1 was only taking into consideration credit risk. Okay. But Basel 2 and Basel 3, CAR was taking into consideration all the three types of risks. So, what is this capital adequacy ratio? It is basically you have the total capital to the risk-weighted assets. Total capital to risk-weighted assets. Now, this risk which you are giving to loans or assets, it takes all the three types of risk, not just the credit risk, but also operational risk as well as market risk. Number one. Number two, the risk which it takes is different for different loans. For example, you're giving loans to a government entity, the risk associated is almost zero. But if you're giving a loan to a private entity or a real estate loan, the risk is very high. So based on which, the weightage is going to be different for different loans. For each and every loan, operational risk is different, credit risk is different, based on which the valuation at the denominator is done. Are you able to follow? Okay. Now this total capital is divided into two types. One is you call it as the tier 1 capital, another one is called as the tier 2 capital. Okay. Now tier 1 capital does not include deposits. Deposits are not part of capital. Deposits are whose money is deposit? It is people's money. It is people's money. Deposits are never part of capital. Remember this. Okay. So tier 1 capital is the most important capital. It is the most important capital or the liquid capital. Liquid capital means you need not stop the operations of the bank to use this capital. That is why it is called as liquid or core capital. Is that clear? You need not stop the operations of the bank. Tier 1 capital is good capital. Tier 2 capital is not that good capital. Okay. Or tier 1 is the core capital. Okay. So this core capital, basically you have some aspects. Okay. So you have paid up capital. Okay, so paid up capital you have, or you have something like the disclosed reserves by the bank. Okay, so you have the disclosed reserves by the bank. Okay, and it also includes something called as statutory assets. Statutory assets. Statutory assets are nothing but the liquid assets which the bank maintains. This is part of your core capital. Paid up capital means something that the promoters of the bank bring in when they are starting the bank. That is basically the paid up capital. Okay. Disclosed reserve means banks have profits. Out of those profits, some are disclosed in the balance sheet, some are not disclosed. Something that is disclosed is called as disclosed reserve or the disclosed profits. Take it this way. Okay. Statutory assets, or you can call it as statutory reserves. You can call it as statutory reserves, are those reserves which are purely in liquid form. Liquid form means you can easily convert them into cash immediately. For example, your G-Secs and all can be easily converted into cash. So more is your statutory reserves, less is your insurance stress. Because you are more, what do you call, more secured. And therefore the insurance facility for the bank will become easy when you have more of statutory reserves. So this is called as your tier 1 capital. Then your tier 2 capital, you have something like the preference shares. Okay. Undisclosed reserves. Heard of them? And you also have subordinate debt. First time? Okay. So, preferential shares are those shares which have a preferential right over the equity shares during the period of insolvency. Anyway, I'll come to that insolvency later in the discussion. So, that means what? If a company is diluted or liquidated, first who is going to be settled? First, you will have secured bondholders. have to be settled. Then subordinate debt or subordinate bond holders, that is this which I have written here. Third, preferential shareholders have to be settled. Then the regular equity shareholders. This is the order. This is the order of settlement. Or that means what? Obviously, bondholders have to be settled first, then comes the shareholders. Okay. In that bondholders also, secured bondholders, then you have subordinate debt, then you have preferential shareholders, and then you have equity shareholders who have to be settled. This is the order of settlement when the company is diluted. Are you getting this? Okay. Now, subordinate debt is the only thing which you do not know, I believe. See, this is undisclosed reserve means whatever profits are there, some are disclosed, some are not disclosed. Not disclosed is going to be part of Tier 2 capital. Okay. Preferential shares for the board of directors, etc. These are preferential shares. Okay. So, they are given these shares. So, that is part of Tier 2 capital. Similarly, subordinate debt is not the secured debt. This is called as unsecured debt. This is also there as part of your insolvency bankruptcy code. There is this term of secured debt and unsecured debt when it comes to your insolvency and bankruptcy code. No, read insolvency bankruptcy. Okay, in insolvency bankruptcy, you have financial creditors and operational creditors. Financial creditors are secured debt holders. Why? Because they take asset with them for giving loan. Operational creditors are unsecured debt. No, I'll come. I'll discuss. Okay, so is this clear till here? Okay, so subordinate debt. So subordinate debt means what? Unsecured debt. Okay, so unsecured debt is basically, suppose SBI has given loan to X company for which it has got a mortgaged asset. You keep an asset for taking loan. Now, this asset is kept as security for issuing some other financial instrument. You know what is a financial instrument? Sorry. Okay. Technology, you know, there is good or bad. This is, okay. Now, see, SBI has given loan to X and X has put an asset as security, mortgaged A. Based on the backing of this asset, there can be another financial instrument that can be issued in the market. Have you heard of this? Okay. So, this financial instrument that is issued in the market is called as a derivative. That is how subprime crisis came. Derivative. Derivative is something that does not have value of its own. So, this paper does not have value of its own. Its value is derived from this asset. Are you getting this? And somebody who is going to buy this derivative instrument, they are the subordinate debt holders. This entity is the major debt. If the company is going to get dissolved, okay. So here, if this A, which is kept as security, and there is a loan that has been given, okay, to this particular entity, they have to be settled first, then only you will settle these entities. This is subordinate debt. This will be coming next. This will be coming first. Okay, so that is subordinate debt. Okay, so this is, so enough of the logic of Basel III. So this is the concept of capital adequacy ratio. Now, as part of Basel II, okay, so the capital adequacy ratio they were saying is 8%. In this 8%, they said 4% Tier 1 capital, 4% Tier 2. 4% Tier 1, 4% Tier 2 capital. Are you getting this? 4.5 RBI. RBI benchmark is higher. RBI benchmark is higher, remember this. Okay. But Basel benchmark is 8% only. Okay. Now, Basel 2, 8%. Basel 3 also talks about 8%. But it says, in this 8%, Tier 1 should be 6. And Tier 2 capital should be 2%. Are you getting this? Okay, no. See, capital adequacy ratio, total capital to risk-weighted assets, as we have discussed. In this, you have both the capitals. No, Tier 1 should be 6% minimum. Okay, understood. Okay, so that is one change. That is one change. Okay, now Basel III, of course, if you observe Basel III, Basel III was talking about capital adequacy ratio of 10.5%. Basel III norms were talking about capital adequacy ratio of 10.5. How is it this 10.5 when they were talking about the basic rate at 8%? Then how will it become 10.5? So that 10.5 which they were talking about, or additional 2.5%, additional 2.5% which they were talking about, is nothing but your capital conservation buffer. Is this clear? Capital conservation buffer. Okay. Now here, RBI's norms were far, far more stringent. Instead of 8, RBI was saying how much? 9%. Capital adequacy ratio of 9. And as part of Basel III, RBI was saying it will be between 11.5%. That means 9 plus another 2.5. That another 2.5 is what? Capital conservation buffer. This is in news. Why is it in news? RBI recently has postponed the last phase of capital conservation buffer of 0.625. Last phase of capital conservation buffer of 0.625. Out of 2.5, 1.875 has been increased already. But 0.625, which is the last one to reach the 2.5, it has postponed this increase of 0.625 to 2020. Why did it do? To inject liquidity. Are you able to follow? Okay, so that is in current affair. Okay. So as part of Basel III, what are the areas which are there in current affairs? One is liquidity coverage ratio. Okay. Second, capital conservation buffer. Capital conservation buffer. Third, you have something called as leverage. Leverage ratio. Okay, fourth, NSFR, net stable funding ratio. NSFR is net stable funding ratio. Five, globally systematically important banks. Okay. Six, higher capital norms. That means increased capital norms. Increased capital, Tier 1 should be 6 minimum. Okay. Or overall, it should be 8 plus 2.5. That means how much? 10.5. That is called as higher capital norms. It has gone down. So it is basically higher capital norms. These are the things which are part of Basel III. And these are the things which are in news also. Too hot, I know. Let's wait. I can't help it, ma'am. Okay. Ida. Idostadi. ఆ పిల్లలకి కావాలి కదా. సర్లే వదిలే, మళ్ళీ చూద్దాంలే, చూద్దాం వస్తుందేమో. తక్కువ పెట్టు, 1 నెంబర్కి. ఓకే ఫైన్, లిసన్ లిసన్. ఓకే ఫైన్. సో క్యాపిటల్ అడిక్వసీ రేషియో RBI norms, how much? 9%. Now, this is 2.5 additional, which they are maintaining, which you call it as what? Capital conservation buffer. Buffer is something extra which is not maintained regularly. This buffer can be between 0 to 2.5 based on the requirement. Buffer can be between 0 to 2.5 based on the requirement. More is a buffer means more will be the lending or less will be the lending? Less will be the lending. More is the buffer means less will be the lending. Means you have to maintain more capital. Suppose for giving 100 rupees loan, just an example, you need to have 9 rupees capital. In a layman term, okay, capital adequacy ratio means 100 rupees loan, you need 9 rupees capital. Okay, now additional 2.5 rupees means for giving 100 rupees loan, you need what? How much capital? 11.5 rupees. Indeed, it means more is your capital required, less is the scope for lending for the banks. Understood, no? Okay, now what is the purpose of capital conservation buffer? Is basically during good times, that means during when the economic growth is good, okay. Okay, so during good times, pro-cyclical lending, during good times, okay. So during good times, that means when you're talking about the cycles of the economy, when the situation of the economy is good, the economy is doing really well. Okay, so banks tend to what? Lend more or increase liquidity, increase loans, tend to lend more. This is called as what? Pro-cyclical lending. Pro-cyclical lending means when the economic growth situation is good, banks start giving more loans. Banks start giving more loans. This is called as pro-cyclical lending. If you observe insolvency bankruptcy code, the code what it was talking about, it says indiscriminate lending by banks, especially after 2010, expecting that the growth rates will increase at a faster pace, has created problems of thin balance sheet syndrome. Okay, so this indiscriminate lending means over lending by the banks. Pro-cyclical means when the cycles of the economy is good, you are going to increase the lending. That is when the economic growth is good, you will increase the lending. That is pro-cyclical lending. Now when the economic situation is bad, generally banks have to follow what? Counter-cyclical lending. What is counter-cyclical? Counter-cyclical means you are countering the cycles of the economy. Countering the cycles of the economy. Countering the cycles of the economy means you have to change that cycle. That is counter-cyclical. So how do you change the cycle? During the bad situation this is. That is during recession period. When the growth situation is bad. Okay. Banks should lend more. So that you will counter the cycle. If they are lending more. If they are following pro-cyclical lending when the economic growth is good. They will not have cash for counter-cyclical policy. During economic growth situation when it is good, growth is good, doing well, they follow pro-cyclical, in line with the cycle, in line with the growth. So banks try to increase loans. Pro-cyclical, over-lending they do. Okay. But when the economic growth situation is bad, you have to revive the cycle, no? That is counter the cycle, that is counter-cyclical policy they should follow. Counter-cyclical policy means you have to break the cycle. How do you break the cycle? During the situation when it is bad also, they have to lend more. So if everything is lent here only, when the situation is good during pro-cyclical policy, then they will not have additional money for lending during the counter-cyclical policy. So to make banks to keep some buffer for counter-cyclical policy, they came up with the concept of capital conservation buffer. Are you following? Pakka no? During good time? That is what? During good time, if they are following pro-cyclical, means what? Banks have to give more loans. If CCB is during good time, हाँ सीसीबी इज मेंटेन्ड ड्यूरिंग गुड टाइम. हाँ सो दैट मीन्स इफ सीसीबी इज 2.5% ड्यूरिंग गुड टाइम, सीसीबी इज 0 to 2.5, सीसीबी इज 2.5 ड्यूरिंग गुड टाइम मीन्स मोर बफर इज मेंटेन्ड ड्यूरिंग गुड टाइम विच यू कैन यूज इट ड्यूरिंग द सिचुएशन ऑफ काउंटर साइक्लिकल पॉलिसी. आर यू गेटिंग दिस? सीसीबी शुड बी हाइएस्ट ड्यूरिंग गुड टाइम. హైయెస్ట్ డ్యూరింగ్ గుడ్ టైమ్ నాట్ బ్యాడ్ టైమ్. తలనొప్పి వస్తుందా? ఓకే సో ఆల్రెడీ బుక్లో ఉంది సీసీబీ పోస్ట్ పోండి అని. ఓకే సో దెర్ ఇస్ నో పాయింట్ ఇన్ లెర్నింగ్ దాట్. అండర్స్టూడ్? వాట్ ఈస్ సీసీబీ? దేర్ క్యాన్ బి అ క్వశ్చన్. సి వాట్ ఆర్ ద థింగ్స్ దట్ ఆర్ పార్ట్ ఆఫ్ బెసెల్ త్రీ? దేర్ క్యాన్ బి అ క్వశ్చన్. If there is banks consolidation which is in news, suppose you have this banks, no, Dena Bank, nobody will ask question, which are the banks which got consolidated? Question will be from Narasimhan committee, because it is the first committee which was talking about consolidation. Like that you read current affair, not, everybody will read PT. Understood? Okay. So, is this clear material here? Pro-cyclical, counter-cyclical, okay, so capital conservation buffer. So now in news is CCB total how much? 2.5. Last phase RBI had to increase 0.625. This should be implemented by 2019. Why Basel III has to be implemented in 2019? But this has been postponed to 2020. Why postponed? Because RBI is focusing on what? Increasing liquidity. Idi. Okay, fine. So this is one thing which is in news. Second news is LCR. Okay, liquidity coverage ratio. Liquidity coverage ratio. Now observe. Banks have to follow, Indian banks are following, have to follow two norms from 2019. What are the two norms? One norm is basically given by your RBI or your monetary policy committee. These are norms like your SLR, which they have to follow, isn't it? 19.25. Okay, another norm which they have to follow is Basel III. That is why Nachiket Mor, Urjit Patel, they were saying, already when we are in line with Basel III, what is the point in having SLR? Remove SLR, no. Understood? So as part of Basel III, there is a requirement of maintenance of liquidity coverage ratio. Liquidity coverage ratio. So how much has to be maintained as part of liquidity coverage ratio? See, what is this liquidity coverage ratio? 30-day stress period which is there for the bank. That is 30-day cash requirements that is there for the bank. For example, for a bank, 30-day cash requirement during stress period is, let's say, 100 crores. Equivalent to 30-day requirement, cash requirement of 100 crores, banks have to maintain liquid assets. Liquid assets. That means 100 crore worth liquid assets have to be maintained in this case. 30 days stress period, there is a cash requirement for the bank. So, for example, let's say next 30 days, cash requirement for the banks is 100 crores. Worth of these 100 crores, liquid asset maintenance should be done. Liquid assets means what? Banks have to maintain in the form of gold, government security, all that. Now, if bank is maintaining it in the form of G-Secs, they can use it for pledging and taking loan. You can use it for pledging and taking loan. So this liquid asset maintenance should be there. That means what? It is an additional burden on the banks in terms of maintenance in the form of liquid assets. Liquid assets, how do you maintain? Your cash you have to maintain in the form of gold. You have to maintain in G-Secs. Means banks' hands are tied. Are you getting this? Okay. Now there is a norm which RBI came up with. In SLR, what is the major component of SLR? Major component of SLR, Praveen phone, major component of SLR is G-Secs. Okay. gold is there, but they maintain in G-Secs because you receive interest. So major component of SLR is G-Secs. Those G-Secs, let's say bank has 15 crore worth G-Secs in the form of SLR. This 15 crore worth of G-Secs can also be shown as part of your LCR. Samajh mein aa raha hai? Additionally, 100 crore you need not maintain. Those things which you are maintaining as part of SLR can also be shown as part of liquidity coverage ratio. Is this clear? Okay, so 15 crore is in G-Secs in SLR. That 15 crore can be shown as part of liquidity coverage ratio. Separately, they need not maintain. If given a chance, banks will push all their SLR as part of LCR. That is not allowed. There is an upper limit. Given a chance, all these G-Secs will be pushed by the bank as categorization under LCR. Okay. But there is an upper limit. That upper limit earlier was 13% of NDTL. That upper limit was 13% of NDTL. That means what? Net demand and time liabilities for a bank is 100 crore. You know what a net demand and time liability. That means how much? 13 crore. Isn't it? That means 13 crore worth of securities which are part of SLR can be shown as part of LCR. This is the facility that is there. Are you getting this? What is the current affair? This 13% has been increased to 15%. This 13% has been increased to 15%. That means 15 crores, which is part of SLR in the form of G-Secs, can be shown as part of LCR. Are you able to follow, ma? Okay, this is what is facility to avail liquidity. Avail liquidity. Facility to avail liquidity for what? Liquidity coverage ratio. This facility to avail liquidity for liquidity coverage ratio has been increased from 13 to 15. Why this is done? To inject what? Obviously. Why? Separately, you need not maintain LCR. Means more you can give loans. That is the meaning. All this is done recently. Why? Because for the sake of injecting liquidity. Like forex swap they have done on one side, which is simple to understand. Another one is this FAL LCR. Increased from 13 to 15, which is part of which norms? Basel III norms. Is this clear, man? Okay, so for injecting liquidity, these two things are clear. That is what I have understood. Okay. Now, this is little. See, don't worry. All the concepts will not be difficult. For example, RRB is there. Dhanadhan 5 point I will dictate. No tension. Their teacher's presence is little required. That's all. So, where concepts come, I will stress more. Wherever there is fact, fast. Okay. So, we'll do that. Now, here, if you see, this is clear. Now, what are the other things that are part of Basel? This is clear. Okay. I hope this is clear. This is clear. 0 to 2.5. Now, leverage means total capital to assets. Not in use, so not much focus. Not much focus. Okay, not in use. So, leverage, see, generally capital adequacy ratio means what? Total capital to what asset? Risk weight. This is total capital to no risk association. It is total capital to assets, that's all. Okay, so don't focus much on that. Now, these two are again in news. There is a discussion in newspapers again. This is net stable funding ratio. What is NSFR? Net stable funding ratio. RBI is talking about 100% NSFR. RBI is talking about 100% NSFR. Okay, so for short-term liabilities, Basel norms are focusing on what? Short-term liquidity, what are the things that are focused? LCR is there and CCB. For long-term loans, you have NSFR. Long-term loans, you have NSFR. What is this long-term loans for a bank? See, long-term loans means, for example, infrastructure loans are there. What is the problem of infrastructure loans? Asset liability mismatch. So loans are given for 20-25 years, but deposits are coming for short term period. You have to use these deposits for funding long term loans. There is this problem. To handle asset liability mismatch issues, you have NSFR, net stable funding ratios. Okay. See, subprime crisis was there because banks were struggling to get funds. Banks were struggling to get funds. And banks were competing with shadow banks. What are shadow banks? Banks were struggling to get funds. NBFCs had a better source of funds because NBFCs borrow very fast without much of a difficulty. But banks have that. But banks will collapse. No, they have to compete in the market. Banks also started funding infrastructure projects. Means banks also need to have a stable source of funding, which they did not have. And that is the reason there was a crisis in the form of subprime crisis. So you try to overdo NBFCs. What NBFCs were doing, you were doing to trying to do. You were trying to ape NBFCs and you collapsed. So you need to have a stable funding. For example, banks have to give loans. Means there should be a stable funding source for the banks. Using that source, you can give long-term loans. That stable source of funds for a period of 1 year. Stable source of funds for a period of 1 year is given by NSFR. Are you getting this? For long-term loans, NSFR. Short-term loans, LCR. Ardhamavutunda? Is it okay? So long-term loan, NSFR, asset liability mismatch. For infrastructure loans, if banks have to give, they need to have a source of fund. No? From where will they have? They need to have a stable source of fund. So RBI is talking about 100% NSFR ratios. 100%. You should have complete source of funds for lending. Why? Already NPAs have increased. Understood. Okay. Then the last one, which is in news, is as part of your Basel III, is globally systematically important banks. See, this globally systematically important banks are huge banks. They pay crores of salaries for MBAs. For example, you have Lehman Brothers, which collapsed during subprime crisis. It's a huge bank. Huge bank. And these banks, if they collapse, economy is going to collapse. Not in a single Indian bank was reflected in GSIB. Not even a single. That means Indian banks are not that huge to get reflected in globally systematically important banks. One is Lehman Brothers, which collapsed in 2007-8, which created problems of subprime crisis. But India came up with Desi system or something like your domestically systematically important bank. So we did not figure out here, but we came up with domestically systematically important banks. So what are these domestically systematically important banks? For example, you have your SBI, which was categorized as DSIB. You have ICICI Bank, which was categorized as DSIB, or your HDFC Bank, which was categorized as DSIB. These are core banks, which if these banks, if SBI collapse, economy will collapse. Such banks are called as DSIB. The concept of DSIB, you derived from Basel III. You derived it from GSIB concept. Understood. So such DSIBs have to maintain higher capital, higher tier 1 capital also. Why? Because if they collapse, what is going to happen? Automatically, banks, economy suppose SBI is contributing 8% of GDP. If the SBI is going to collapse, automatically GDP, it will get affected. That is DSIB. More capital they'll maintain, no more capital adequacy ratios, more CRR conditions, all this capital buffer, all this is for DSIBs. Done. Okay. So for injecting liquidity, something that is in newspaper discussion since last 2.5 months or 2 months, last one is your heard of them? Read? No. Last 15-20 days, 25 days, there is this discussion of external benchmark. What is this external benchmark? Economy, no, it changes fast. You should update. Okay, so see, there is internal benchmarking, no? Okay, so internal benchmark was what? Whatever I have discussed. For example, you have your prime lending rate. Okay, as I have discussed, you have base rate. And we discussed what? MCLR. These are all internal benchmarks. Internally, bank is going to set the rate based on some criteria or formula. That is internal benchmarking. This internal benchmarking did not lead to monetary transmission. So RBI said enough of internal benchmarking. Now link it up, link your interest rate straight with external benchmark rates. This is in news. Okay. So for example, let's say there is a bank X. Okay. This bank says, if I want to give a loan of 100 rupees, etc., my costing, etc., if I take into consideration, okay, I need 9 rupees interest or 9 rupees to cover my costs. 9 rupees to cover my costs. 100 rupees loan I have to give means to cover all the costs. I need how much? 9 rupees. What is this external benchmark? External benchmark, one of the external benchmark is repo rate. Directly link your interest rate to this external benchmark called repo rate. That is what RBI was saying. Okay, so that means what? Repo rate is 6%. Means what? The loans which you give should be 9 plus 6%. 9 plus 6% means to cover your cost. You said how much? 9 means 9% plus 6 means how much? Approximately it is how much? 15%. You have directly linked your repo rate to cost of funds. That is external benchmarking. For covering your cost of funds, you need 9 rupees or 9%. Okay, you have to link your interest rate directly to repo means 9 plus 6 means how much? 15. Okay, now in this 15, you can come up with your margin. For example, real estate loan is risky, so you will give it at 18%. That is 3% more than your set rate of 15. Personal loan, etc., if it is less risky, etc., okay, you will give it at 16%. Ardhamavutunda? Okay. Covering the cost, you need 8-9%. 9 rupees you need. 100 rupees loan, if they have to give. To cover 100 rupees loan, what is the cost of funds? There is cost of funds for the bank? No. Deposits it takes and it gives loan. There is an interest rate involved when bank takes deposits. It has to give interest? No. Okay, that is the cost incurred by the bank. So taking that costing, whether it is repo rate or whether it is deposit rate, there is cost for the bank. So to cover those costs, okay, if you have to give 100 rupees loan, you need how much? 9 rupees. That means 9%. Then you are obviously not just cover your cost, no. You need some margin. How do you get that profit? You link it up to some external benchmark. If external benchmark is 6%, that is repo, which is currently repo, means 9% plus 6 is the link. So you're linked up to your 9% to a cost means how much is the interest rate that the banks will charge on an average? 15%. And the base rate for the bank will be 15. Base rate for the bank will be 15. Now it will be above 15 for some loans because risk is high, 18%, 19%. Some loans it will be less, 16%, because risk is less. For example, government company it is giving, it will give at 15 also or 15.5. There is a spread. Always loan spread is there. Interest rate spread will there. Understood. Okay. Now, what is RBI saying? Now, if I reduce repo rate from 5% to 6, sorry, 6% to 5%, automatically your interest rate should become 14. Automatically, it should be visible for me. Okay. Your real estate loan, 18%, you said no, it should become what? 17%. It visible, transparency. Internal, no, it is external. Ardhamayinda? Bank, no, no, cost of, based on cost of funds, you decided 9%. You can't change cost of funds whenever you feel like. So you, after doing all the calculations, said cost of funds is 9. Okay, so directly you have linked it to repo. So you are giving it at 14. Now in Feb, 6.25 to 6 they reduced. Once they have reduced it from 6.25 to 6, this 15% should become 14.75. straight, that is external benchmark. There are negatives also for means. Okay, so is this clear? Understood? Okay, for external benchmarking, they were saying one is repo, another, there are other two. One, another one is T-bills, 91-day T-bills, and also 182-day T-bills. 91-day T-bill, 182-day T-bills. T-bills generally come in four format. 14-day, 91-day, 91 into 2, 182, 182 into 2, 364. 14 days currently is not in use. Okay, so you have only 91, 182 and 364. In your current affairs, this is there. T-bills is there. Why T-bills is there in current affairs is foreign investments, foreign portfolio investors can currently invest money into T-bills. Earlier, foreign portfolio investors could push money only into G-Secs. That too, those bonds with maturity periods of minimum 3 years. This clause has been removed by Arun Jaitley. Maturity period, you know, bond maturity period. So 3 years maturity period for such bonds only, you can push money. Who? FIs. But that clause has been removed by Jaitley means indirectly, they can also push their money into T-bills. T-bill maturity is less than 1 year. Got this point. Okay, that is why it is in current affair. Okay, now, 18, generally T-bills do not offer interest. They are called as zero coupon bonds. Coupon bonds offer interest. Non-coupon bonds, no interest. Non-coupon. Coupon means what? Interest. Non-coupon, no interest. Okay, T-bills generally do not offer interest. T-bills do not offer interest because they are issued at discounted rate. 100 rupees original price, they issued at discounted price, but they'll purchase it at the original price. So that is why T-bills do not offer interest. But interest can be calculated. So the T-bill interest calculation which you do, that also can be used, T-bills, 91-day T-bill can be used as external benchmark. 182-day T-bill can be used as external benchmark. Suppose this 91-day T-bill external benchmark, 9% is the interest. Repo rate you want to link, you can link to repo. If you want to link it to T-bill interest, you link it. You want to link it to 182-day T-bill, you can link it. That is up to the bank. But these are the three which they were talking about as external benchmarks. Why T-bills? Because short term, no, repo is short term instrument. Therefore, you are linking it to T-bill. You can't link it to G-Sec. Ardhamainda, is that okay? Okay, so 91 day, 182 day T-bill. Negative is, in 1 year period, T-bill interest or coupons there was a variation of 100 basis points. There is so much of fluctuation with respect to T-bill interest. When there is so much of fluctuation, what will happen? Banks' deposit rates are almost constant. But when they are lending money and deciding the interest, if there is so much of fluctuation, okay, their net interest margin will reduce. Their net interest margin, interest, they get some margin, no. They do not have control on this area. They have control, this is constant and this is continuously changing because of T-bill linking. Means they will not have control over the lending rate. That is what banks were complaining. Their net interest margin, that margin which they get, it's not in their hand, it's going to reduce. This is about liquidity and current areas related to liquidity. Hope it is clear. Okay. Current gone, huh? Still. Economy itself is heat up. More than that, see the environment. Okay, so till here, I think it is clear. Now, we'll shift into another area which is little difficult. Then comes simple area. Simple area, RRB, small finance, differentiated banking, that we will do. But this area is also important. This area is basically NPAs. Now, with respect to resolving NPA, now see, government of India was successful, or Modi's government was extremely successful with respect to insolvency bankruptcy. And therefore, there can be a question. Are doing business index ranking improved because of insolvency bankruptcy? 2018, okay, so there were some amendments which they brought in with respect to insolvency bankruptcy. That is what you are reading in your current affairs. It is a hardcore technical topic. Which one? Insolvency bankruptcy. So, UPSC difficult question will not come in insolvency bankruptcy. Only simple question they can ask, because it is important. And success has been very high. So many cases have been resolved. Okay, India's case, the recoveries, liquidation, etc., hardly it was 4.3%. It's the worst among most of the countries. And today our doing business ranking increase, everything increased because of insolvency bankruptcy board. Okay, so now, okay, fine. So, what is the difference between stressed assets and NPAs? Stressed assets will include NPAs. They will include restructured loans, and they will also include loans not substandard, written off. Praveen? మొత్తం రికార్డింగ్ అంతా ప్రవీణ్ ప్రవీణ్ అని ఉంటుంది. ప్రవీణ్ అది చూడమ్మా, ఏసీ వస్తుందో లేదో సార్ చెక్ చేయి. ఓకే, సో స్ట్రెస్డ్ అసెట్స్ ఆర్ డిఫరెంట్ ఫ్రమ్ ఎన్పిఎస్, దట్ మచ్ యూ షుడ్ నో, బికాస్ స్ట్రెస్డ్ అసెట్స్ హ్యాస్ అ వైడర్ స్కోప్. వైడర్ స్కోప్ ఇస్ బేసికలీ ఎన్పిఎస్ ఆర్ కవర్డ్, యూ హ్యావ్ రీస్ట్రక్చర్డ్ లోన్స్. రీస్ట్రక్చర్డ్ లోన్ మీన్స్ ద లోన్ టైమ్ పీరియడ్ ఇస్ చేంజ్డ్. For example, they have to pay this year, you give them concession, okay, next you take 6 months more, 1 year more. That is called as restructured loan. Loans written off means these are loans which are pushed off from the balance sheet. They are not visible. It's not visible on the balance sheet. As non-performing asset, you have removed it from the balance sheet. That is called as loan written off. Though they will put in efforts with respect to some kind of recovery. Is this clear? Okay. See, subprime crisis was not the cause for NPA increase. If subprime crisis would have been the cause for NPA increase, 2008, 9, 10, NPA should have been high. But NPA increase was highest between 2011 to 2015. Three times NPAs increased in between 2011 to 2015. Is this clear? Okay. So RBI came up with identifying the defaulters. Now also through this mechanism of NPA, okay, through this mechanism of something called as insolvency bankruptcy. So these NPAs should shift to special mention accounts. That is the discussion in the newspapers. So NPAs getting shifted to special mention accounts. So special mention accounts is a categorization of defaulters. It is not categorization of NPAs. I think you know it. NPA, special mention account is before the loan becomes a NPA. Okay. So you have three categories, SMA 0, SMA 1 and SMA 2. Three categories of special mention accounts. So if there is a default for up to 30 days, there is no principal nor interest payment. It will be categorized under special mention account 0. 31 to 60 days, it will be categorized under special mention account 1. Okay, then you have from 61 to 90, less than 90 days, it will be categorized under special mention account 2. Remember this. This special mention account category is not categorization of NPA. It is categorization before the loan becomes NPA. See, RBI came up with asset quality review in 2015-16. What review? Asset quality review. Why? NPAs increased three times. And therefore, asset quality review was launched by RBI and government. Asset quality review means the loan quality with the banks. Asset quality with the banks has been checked. Okay. Is this clear till here? Okay. Now, after it crosses 90 and above, the loan becomes what? NPA. Non-performing asset. Now, non-performing asset, you have again, you have something like substandard, you have doubtful, and you have loss making. Now, this is the categorization under NPS. You have standard also. Standard, of course, no problem. So, substandard means from 90 to 1 year, there is no payment that is done. If the loan stays as substandard for 1 year, if the loan stays in substandard category for 1 year, automatically you will categorize it as doubtful. 1 year, okay, or generally if it crosses 18 months. Okay, so 1 year as substandard, then it will be categorized as doubtful. Loss making means completely the loan recovery chances are gone. No recovery chances. Already bank has given up hopes. It is already gone. The chances or probability of recovering the loan is very, very minimum. Is this clear? Okay. So to handle all this mechanism in the recent past, especially after 2015, okay, so they came up with schemes like strategic debt restructuring. Okay. So in 2016, they came up with schemes like scheme for sustainable structuring of stressed assets. Scheme for sustainable structuring of, so scheme, four S's are there. Scheme for sustainable structuring of stressed assets. Okay. And in 2016 only, there was this discussion of asset quality review that was conducted by RBI. And then in 2016 only, they came up with something like your insolvency bankruptcy code. Insolvency bankruptcy code. Important. 2018, there is an amendment. That is why this is important. Understood. There is amendment to insolvency bankruptcy code, and therefore some areas you should know, at least terms in insolvency bankruptcy. I'll only teach you the terms without much of a conflict. Other things you can, once you read anything, you can understand. So insolvency bankruptcy code, and you also had this logic of, in 2018, they came up with Project Sashakt. Project Sashakt is in current affairs. No, this is basically based on the recommendations of Sunil Mehta Committee. Project Sashakt, based on the recommendations of Sunil Mehta Committee. Okay. As part of Project Sashakt, there was inter-creditor agreement. What agreement? Inter-creditor agreement. As part of Project Sashakt, there was inter-creditor agreement. Okay. So that is also Project Sashakt you should know with respect to NPA. And earlier, and of course, there is this concept of prompt corrective action which was launched. Okay. So this prompt corrective action launched by RBI. Okay, so prompt corrective action, initially, there were, how many banks were pushed under prompt corrective action? 11 banks, okay. 11 banks pushed under prompt corrective action. That means these banks have some problem with respect to four factors. Prompt corrective action takes into consideration four factors. These four factors determine whether the bank is doing good or there is some corrective action that is required. Okay, so what are the four factors which are taken for prompt corrective action? Okay. Two are visible, no? Only two are visible. Okay, so capital adequacy ratio, NPA, okay, leverage, and profitability. In your magazines, whatever they are writing is only partially right. Basically, they say return on asset should be less than 0.25, but it is actually not true. Even in this return on, even this prompt corrective action, there is subcategorization under different risks. So therefore, such questions of numbers will not be asked in prompt corrective action. That is what I feel. Why? Because it is difficult. You can't remember. Okay, so but at least what are the four areas which they take for prompt corrective action? That much you should know. What are the four areas for prompt corrective action? It is, one is capital adequacy ratio. Generally, under capital adequacy ratio, there is three risk categories. One, two, three. But generally, they say less than 9%. But it's actually not true. But capital adequacy ratio is one factor. Second factor, NPA. NPA should be less. Third factor is leverage, means here more of debt for the bank. Leverage, more of debt than equity. More debt, more appu, more borrowing. Understood? Okay, that is leverage. And profitability. Easy to understand. If I write return on asset, means you'll not understand. It is basically profitability of the bank. These are the four areas for prompt corrective action. Is this clear? Okay. So that was also in news. Okay. And there were other things also. Earlier there was this 5:25 scheme, etc. Okay. 5:25 scheme for handling. Okay. And there was a suggestion in before last year economic survey, which talks about an institution called as PARA. What is PARA? Public Asset Reconstruction Agency. Government-related ARC. Government-related ARC, Asset Reconstruction Company. See, if you know, there was earlier an act called as SARFAESI. Okay. So, including all this, you came up with insolvency bankruptcy now. Okay. So, SARFAESI Act 2002. So, this SARFAESI Act basically talks about two important aspects. One is it talks about securitization. Second, this act talks about asset reconstruction companies. Project Sashakt also, the chances of success is very less. Why, I will tell you. Okay, so same logic. See, asset reconstruction company, securitization. These are the two things that were focused as part of SARFAESI. Banker, no. Banker can sell off the assets if they are not paying the loans without taking the permission of the civil court. That is what was SARFAESI Act's major theme. Securitization and asset reconstruction. Okay, so securitization means the mortgage assets which the bank has, it can be kept somewhere and cash can be taken. These assets can be kept somewhere and liquid cash can be taken. That is securitization. Okay, asset reconstruction companies, this is basically SARFAESI Act suggested for private asset reconstruction companies, private ARCs. What is the role of ARC? Recover what? Bad loans. The role of ARC is recovering bad loans. Okay. So, but initially, according to SARFAESI Act, ARC can initially pay 5% of the loan value to the bank. How much? 5% of the loan value to the bank. Rest of the amount it will pay after the money is recovered. Are you able to follow? 5%. So that means if SBI has 100 crore bad loan, okay, there is an ARC company. Now, this bad loan has been purchased by this ARC company. Okay. Let's say it has been purchased for 50 crore. Bad loan, no. Okay. Now, 5% only is initially paid. 5% of the total amount is paid. Rest of the amount is paid by ARC only after recovery. Initially, that was the clause. Okay. Now, the promoters of the bank were also promoters of ARC. That is why ARCs failed. If promoters of bank and promoters of ARC same, what will happen if the bank, if this promoter knows, if I get 45 crores for this, also it is okay. This loan for 100 crore loan, if you get 45, also it is decent. But if instead of 50, if he has to give it for 45, he will be worried about CBI inquiry. You wantedly gave for 45 because you are the promoter of ARC also. And from under the table, you would have taken 1 crore. But the truth is, probably 45 crores also he's getting, it is fine. So he's afraid in terms of taking this operational decision. Why to sell and get it on my head? Why to sell this bad loan at 45 and tomorrow CBI inquiry and they'll talk all sweet, sweet words, you know, CBI inquiry. So why should you get all this on your head? Why all this? So therefore, I'll not sell. So promoters of bank and ARC being same was a hindrance for success of ARC. That is one. Second problem for success of ARC was 5% only initially you are giving. That means bank's bad debt is not cleared till the time there is recovery. Okay. In 2014-15, they brought in some amendments. Why? NPA has increased. So you want to solve. So what was that? One such amendment was initially, that is, ARC will pay how much? 15% first. Recovered, after recovery, the rest of the amount will be paid. This was the change which they brought in. 15% they'll pay, after recovery, rest of the amount will be paid. But here there is a problem. What is the problem? How will ARCs get the funds? For in making initial payment, that is a problem for even Project Sashakt. Project Sashakt to be successful also the problem is, how, from where will the ARC get the money? Clear? Difficult? No, no. Ah, 2015, 2016, these two schemes they came. Okay. So, strategic debt restructuring means, what will happen? The same applies to your insolvency, bankruptcy also. Okay. So, suppose there is a company, 100 crore loan is given. By three lenders. 100 crore loan is given to a company by three lenders. Okay. Now this 100 crore has become defaulted. That means NPA. Now strategic debt restructuring means if these three, out of these three, okay, out of these three, if 75% by value they accept to restructure this loan, that means convert this loan into equity, the process will be started. 75% out of 100 means how much? 75 crores, isn't it? That means if A and B accept, if A and B accept for restructuring, automatically the restructuring process is going to start. Why? Because A and B account to 75% of value. Okay, is this clear? 75% of value or 60% by number. That means what? Two members have accepted out of three. Two out of three is how much? 66%. 2 out of 3 is 66. So, 66 they have accepted. So, automatically the process will start. Now, insolvency bankruptcy code, when you talk about this committee of creditors, heard of it, this committee of creditors, how much approval is needed now? 66% by value. Earlier it was how much? 75%. No? You have read? Okay. So, the same, this change has been brought. And till the time this company, once the rescheduling, restructuring process is accepted, these creditors will become owners of this company for a temporary period. That is why it is strategic debt restructuring. They are the strategic owners. ABC will become owners of the company till the time this loan is restructured. Ownership. Temporary only. Banker cannot run a company. It is only temporary. This is about SDR. Basic. Okay. Scheme for sustainable structuring of stressed assets. Here there is no ownership change. No ownership change. That means ABC will not become owner of the company. That is what you will remember. ABC will not temporarily become owner of this company. Same case in this S4A scheme. But here scheme for sustainable structuring of stressed assets. Sustainability of the loan has to be checked. What is the sustainability of the loan? ABC together, they will appoint an independent entity. Now this independent entity will check the sustainability of the loan. What is the meaning of sustainability? Whether the loan will be recovered or not. What is the probability of the loan, at least 50% of the loan should get recovered. That means 100 crore may at least 51 crores. Then only the process of restructuring will start. Then only this debt will be converted into equity. Are you able to follow? Prompt corrective action, how many factors? Four factors. That is clear. Prompt corrective action, four factors. That is more than sufficient. Okay. SARFAESI Act focused on what? Securitization and private ARCs. Okay. Okay. But still there were problems. So therefore, these reforms. Okay. And S4A, no ownership change. ABC will not take up the ownership. Okay, but sustainability is checked. Sustainability means out of 100 crore, at least 51 crore recovery, there should be guarantee. Without guarantee or sustainability, you will not convert this debt into equity. Okay, you want break or you're okay? Okay. Okay, so let's continue. 1 o'clock, I will wind up for a break. long break. Okay, so is it okay? You can sit for one more hour. Okay, chalo. So now these are the things which you should be knowing. Current affair is never waste. Huh? If question comes, fantastic. Question doesn't come, use it for mains. It's as simple as that. Technicality, you can't use it for mains, obviously, but the focus or the objective, you can write your question a little better. Okay, so if the question directly comes, fantastic. Question comes from history, also okay. We are trying to hit some, I'm trying to hit some history also and concept also when I'm explaining. Let's see. Naseeb. Okay. Now, then, so this is, then comes your Project Sashakt. Which committee Project Sashakt? Sunil Mehta committee. Recommendations of Sunil Mehta committee. Okay. Project Sashakt is for handling what? Stressed assets. Last July, current affairs. July or August. Okay. Follow it. Five-pronged strategy. UPSC, I doubt they will ask you the five-pronged strategy, obviously, because it's not a technical exam, but at least you will know five-pronged strategy. Sunil Mehta, stressed assets. That much though you should know. Okay. So, five-pronged strategy is basically, if the loan value is less than 50 crore, okay, the NPA resolution or the stressed asset, resolving these stressed assets will happen within the bank itself. Within the bank itself. Okay. Second, if the loan value is between 50 to 500 crore, they will go ahead with inter-creditor agreement. See, remember, inter-creditor agreement will be applicable only when there is consortium of lenders. Not a single lender. Consortium of lenders. That means group of lenders have given loan. That is called consortium of lenders. That you should remember. If one single lender, you will not have this focus of inter-creditor agreement. Consortium of lenders. Out of this consortium of lenders, there should be approval given by the majority. If majority approval is given, suppose 66% by value approval is given. 66% by value approval is given, then the minority fellow, suppose this C is a minority, he says, we don't want to convert this bad debt. Okay, but A and P are the majority players, means C should accept. C has to accept or sell off his assets to A and B. That is called inter-creditor agreement. Now, you have to resolve it within 180 days, as it is for your insolvency bankruptcy code. If you are not resolving it, then probably it will be referred to NCLT, National Company Law Tribunal. National Company Law Tribunal. These are the adjudicating authorities with respect to your insolvency bankruptcy code. There are two adjudicating authorities with respect to your insolvency bankruptcy code. What are the two adjudicating? One is NCLT, which will handle companies as well as limited liability partnerships. NCLT is the adjudicating authority. That means it will take up cases. It will take up insolvency cases. That is adjudicating. You know what is adjudicating? Polity. Okay. With respect to companies registered under Companies Amendment Act 2013 or Limited Liability Partnership Act 2008. LLPs in news. LLP is in news, current affairs. LLP is in current affairs. Limited liability partnership companies are like partnership firms only, but the partners will not have complete liability. Like the company, they will not have complete liability. If something wrong happens, they are not completely liable. That is the benefit of LLP. So government asked for last 2 years, consistently those LLPs which were not filing taxes, those LLPs which are not filing taxes, government wanted to push them off or ask them to file taxes. Why? These LLPs can be used for money laundering. That is the reason. Money laundering, converting black into white. So you have just set up last 2 years, you are not filing any kind of taxes. So government decided to focus on those LLPs which were not filing taxes since last 2 years because they can use it as a shell company for converting black money into white. So in that context, LLP was in current affair. Okay. So, and debt recovery tribunal will handle cases with respect to individuals and partnerships. Individuals and partnership firms. NCLT for companies and LLPs. Is this clear, ma'am? Okay, fine. Then the third is more than 500 crore, more than 500 crore, they are going to come up with asset management companies. For example, ICICI Prudential. Okay, so ICICI entity was handling, is working as an asset management company for your Bharat 22. Heard of Bharat 22? Okay, so Bharat 22 is basically a ETF, exchange trade fund. It was in news, continuously it was in news. Okay, so there will be some asset management companies which will come up and design these ETFs also. So ICICI was the asset management company which was handling your Bharat 22. So you will hand over the case to asset management companies or alternate investment fund companies, AIFs you call it as. That is the third area of your project, Shashakt. Fourth, if nothing is working out, then you will come up with pushing in insolvency bankruptcy code, IBC. Okay. And the five-prong strategy, last one is you have an asset trading platform. Asset trading platform where NPA assets can be traded or as well as good assets can be traded. Bad assets can be traded. Good assets can also be traded. Okay. So trading, selling, buying and selling of loans or assets. Now securities. So this asset trading platform is also going to be facilitated as part of the fifth strategy. So I don't think he will ask what are the five, obviously, but what I feel is five-prong strategy, Sunil Mehta handling stressed assets. That is Project Seshat. Inter-creditor agreement is different from joint lenders forum, which was in news last few years. Okay. Intercreditor agreement, majority accepts, the minority fellow also has to accept. Okay. This is about Project Shashakt. Okay. Let's go ahead with okay, one more thing before this, easy topic is there was interim dividend transfer. This Urjit Patil resigned. Okay, RBI, it was in current affairs. So interim dividend transfer from RBI to government. Okay, in Feb, 28,000 crore interim dividend transfer. Interim dividend transfer. Now, you know what is dividend, okay? If you are the owner of a company or a corporate company and you're holding shares, that is how you become owner, you expect or you have the right to take dividend. Similarly, government is the owner of RBI. Government is the owner of RBI and therefore, government has rights to take dividends from RBI. It holds the right to take dividends from RBI. RBI is the largest profit-making PSU, in fact, which gives a lot of profits to government. And out of the profits, some profits are kept as reserves by RBI. The rest of the profits have to be transferred by RBI to government in the form of dividend. Is this clear? Okay. Now, why is it called as interim dividend transfer? Why is it called as interim dividend? RBI year is basically from July to June. July to June. And it will transfer dividends to government in August. Remember this, it will transfer dividends to government in August. This is called as dividend transfer. Regular dividend transfer. It happens in August. Already in August, 40,000 crores has been transferred by RBI to government. Every year in August, it will transfer. Now this is interim dividend transfer because this has been done in Feb. This is not a regular transfer. This transfer of 28,000 crores should have been done for the next year, next fiscal. For some receipts for the next fiscal, government is using to handle its deficits in the current fiscal. Understood something? Next fiscal. No. See, next year. See, what is the target according to interim budget? Interim budget, what is the budgetary estimate 2019-20 fiscal deficit target? How much? 3.4% of GDP. You want to maintain your deficit means you have to push the gap between revenues and expenditure. For the current fiscal, that means earlier, budgetary estimate 2018-19, budgetary estimate. You know what is budgetary estimate? Everybody knows it. Sure? Okay. So, budgetary estimate 2018-19, I'll discuss when I'm discussing current affairs of fiscal policy. Okay, budgetary estimate 2018-19, fiscal deficit target was 3.3. Now this budget slipped its target. And that means you want to maintain that. Revised estimate is also there. Revised estimate, budgetary estimate, revised estimate. 2018-19 revised estimate is also there. So revised estimate, it was 3.4. That means already you slipped your target. Revised estimate 2018-19. So you want to maintain your fiscal deficit means you need to increase your what? Revenue. Or you need to reduce your expenditure. Now interim transfer of 28,000 crore, you are doing it in Feb. This should be given in August. Next year it will fall in next fiscal. No, it is coming up after June for RBI or for government after March 31st, but you have done it when? In Feb. Means it is an interim dividend. You are doing it in Feb because you want to show it in your current fiscal as revenue, so that you can maintain your deficit targets. Next year receipts you are using for bailing your current year deficits. Is that clear? Okay, so this is, and since last year there was already interim transfer of 10,000 crore last Feb. Again, this year, 28,000 crore. It is a continuous process. It is not good. Though government has a right over dividends of RBI, if it is done when there is emergency, nothing wrong. Last year, 10,000 crore you pushed in. But again, this year, you are doing 28,000 crore. That means it has become a continuous affair. Okay, so which is not good. Okay. Now, always remember, for RBI, the profits are high because RBI's expenditure is hardly 1/7 of its income. RBI's expenditure is hardly 1/7 of its income. Okay. What is the source of income for RBI? 1 is RBI receives a lot of money from foreign currency assets. It maintains bonds, deposits in foreign accounts. Okay, in the form of gold or in some other treasury bills, etc. So, foreign currency assets which it is maintaining, it receives some money. So, that is a major source of revenue for RBI. Second is, when RBI is issuing government bonds, on behalf of government is issuing bonds, it also receives something called as interest. When RBI is facilitating government with respect to issuing bonds, it is facilitating government with respect to issuing bonds, there are service charges which are paid by the government to RBI. All this is income for RBI. And this income is very high. In 2011-12 till 2015-16, there was a continuous fall with respect to dividend transfer from RBI to government. Earlier, dividend transfer was 68,650 crores. It drastically reduced to almost like 33,000 crores by the time of 2015-16. Reason being, expenditure for RBI increased because of demonetization. Because of demonetization, RBI had to mint more money. RBI's major expenditure is minting currency. So it had to push in more 2000 rupee notes, mint more currency. So RBI's expenditure increased by the time of 2014-15, etc. That is the reason RBI expenditure increased. So its dividend transfer to government has drastically decreased from 68,000 crores to almost like 33,000 crores. And that was the conflict between Urjit Patil and government. Now Urjit Patil ego got hurt, you know. Raghuram Rajan also made statements. Okay, so you can't say in our pocket I have only 1 rupee, in your pocket you have 10 rupees, so give it. No, you have to compare all the RBIs. That is what they were trying to explain. But the logic is it decreased because expenditures, RBI incurs expenditure, minting money, paying money to the salaries to the employees of RBI, etc. So there is the expenditure also. But generally expenditure is quite lower than the income. So reserves it builds. After building some reserves, the rest is transferred as dividend. That is why it was in news. Interim dividend transfer. Okay. Clear? First is why interim, you should know. Why dividend transfer? Does bank has, in mains again, probably we can discuss why can government take it? What are the problems? Obviously, 1 lakh crore. See, dividend transfer is how much, how do you decide how much has to be transferred? So already 68,000 crore has been transferred. It's not nobody gives, it is RBI's income in terms of foreign currency assets. Or it can be in terms of income returns from different sources. Okay, so already 68,000 crore given, 40,000 in August they gave. This Feb, how much they gave? 28,000. Almost like 68,000 crore is given. Decent amount, no? Decent only. Okay. Government wants more means we can't say. It's a conflict. Fine. So now insolvency and bankruptcy code. Don't worry about the technicality. I am telling you before only. Like this is a little technical. But you should know some entities under this. Okay, so some terms and terminology, if you know, I think the job is done. Okay, so is it successful? According to government, according to statistics, 101% successful. So why in current affairs, though it was pushed in 2016, why in current affairs for 2019 is basically amendment that has been done. And Supreme Court also has accepted few things as part of Section 29, Section 12, as part of Insolvency Bankruptcy Code. Section's not important. Okay, so only for understanding. Now, there are two things here. One is insolvent and another is bankruptcy. What is the difference? No difference. Both are same. Insolvent means somebody who has taken loan but is not in a position to pay back. Insolvent. Okay. Bankruptcy is a court procedure. No, it's a court procedure, legal procedure. It's a legal procedure. Okay. Got the difference? No. Insolvent means taking loan, not in a position to pay. Now, taking loan, not in a position to pay, can be because there are genuine defaulters and you have these fantastic people like Vijay Mallya who are called as willful defaulters. Now, you can't handle willful defaulters, cannot participate in insolvency and bankruptcy. Willful defaulters cannot participate. Similarly, promoters of the company cannot participate in the code. That means in the resolution process. But this amendment is promoters of the company cannot participate. Exemption is given to MSMEs in the recent amendment. Okay, that is the amendment. That promoters of the company cannot participate in the procedure. That exemption is given to MSMEs. In the amendment, Okay, fine. So who is a willful defaulter? Ability to pay, but he will not pay. Okay. Second, loan taken for a particular purpose, use it for another purpose. Money siphoned off. He will mortgage assets for the bank. He will use the same asset somewhere else also. Or like real estate property. Same land, you will sell it to number of people, no? Same logic applies. So all these three things, if they do, they are termed as what? Willful defaulters. All prompt corrective action related aspects, SDR, all that will work out only for genuine defaulters. Genuinely, they have done business. They are not in a position to pay back. They are making losses. And you have to restructure. Okay. So earlier, what is the, but not for willful defaulters. Willful defaulters, no law, no code applies. Is this clear? Okay. Now, what is the genuine procedure in India? Actually, the best insolvency code is UK's code. The best insolvency code in the world is UK's code. Worst method of insolvency and liquidation almost is India's till now. The recovery rates are hardly 4 to 4.3%, which is pathetic. Understood? No. So liquidation procedure itself is an Herculean task here. Now, first thing is, if the business is in loss, you do not give scope for restructuring in India. Earlier, what we used to do, business is in loss means liquefy. Or you liquidate, sell the assets, liquidate. That was the procedure. That is what you'll remember. Okay. But now, after insolvency bankruptcy code, you will come up with a procedure for restructuring the business. There is some scope is given. And in this process of restructuring, the creditor will not torture the debtor. In this 180 days procedure, when it is going on, the business, if it has to be conducted, it can be conducted regularly. The creditor, the lender, will not torture the borrower. Why? Otherwise, what will happen? At least some money he will make if the business is running, which he can pay back. If you stop everything, from how will you pay back the loan? Are you getting this? Okay, so that was one of the aspects which was also focused. So there are some terms which you should be knowing. So one is regulator. So it is Insolvency Bankruptcy Board of India. Who is the regulator for this procedure? Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India. You should know about adjudicating authorities. So you have to file the case in with this authority only initially. So what are the two adjudicating authorities? One is you have NCLT and you also have the debt recovery tribunals. Okay, NCLT and debt recovery tribunals. Okay, so you should be knowing. Okay, then you should know about a term called as committee of creditors. Okay, these committee of creditors play a critical and crucial role in terms of deciding the plans of insolvency professional. Okay, now this committee of creditors are financial creditors. They are financial creditors. They are not operational creditors. Okay, so who are financial creditors? These are secured creditors. Operational creditors. Committee of creditors means which creditor? Financial credit, that's it. Okay, operational creditors are unsecured. Okay, for example, suppose I am running this organization or institute, okay, for which, let's say, I am taking loan from a bank. Now I would have mortgaged an asset for taking the loan from SBI. Now this SBI is a financial creditor for this organization. And it is secured because I have mortgaged an asset. It is an asset-backed credit. And therefore, it is a secured credit. Okay. Now suppose, let's say this organization has become bankrupt, insolvent. But there would be teachers who were teaching in this organization. I would have told them I will pay you money after the course is over. Okay. But insolvency means no money. But I owe money to them also. That is also credit. Don't you think so? I need to pay them. Okay, that means there are several employees, there is a research team who is working on the content, or there is these teachers who are working day in, day out for the organization, etc. I need to make consistent payments to them. I owe credit. Similarly, Vijay Mallya also. There are employees of Vijay Mallya, 2 years he did not give salary. He owes money to them. Okay, and when there is this flight travel that is happening, okay, there is catering services, etc. Vijay Mallya is not going to prepare food by himself, no. Somebody has to serve. Okay, so that means he owes monies to these caterers, etc. Now, these are not the financial creditors. I owe money. I am a debtor here. I owe money to these employees, or Vijay Mallya owes money to these catering agencies, etc. But these people are operational creditors. These are operational creditors or unsecured creditors. Got the difference, I believe. Financial creditors, operational creditors, actually, in news. Earlier, what happened was, whenever you are liquidating the company or whenever you are coming up with the insolvency or restructuring plan, first financial creditors are going to be settled. And then only you will come up with settling the operational creditor. In fact, last you are going to settle the operational creditors in the process. Now, initially, Supreme Court was saying it is violating Article 14 of the Constitution because both are creditors. But in the 2018 amendment, Supreme Court has accepted. What is the acceptance given by the Supreme Court? This differentiation between the financial creditor and operational creditor in IBC is okay. It is not a violation to Article 14, provided the differentiation has been done appropriately. Are you getting this? Okay, so that is part of the amendment. Second current affair with respect to IBC is, generally home buyers are treated as financial creditors and not operational creditors. Home buyers. Suppose there is a builder, he is building an apartment, okay, and you paid initially 40 lakhs for getting your apartment, 1 crore. Initially, you made some payment, you will make 30 crore, 40 lakh, 30 lakh, 40 lakh. Now, you are a home buyer. In this case, in the recent amendment, home buyer is also seen or made as financial creditor. Why? There were a lot of cases against these builders in the courts. Otherwise, home buyer generally was treated as what? Operational creditor. You purchased the house, you gave 40 lakh. Okay, but he did not deliver, he did not give your apartment, and he did not construct the apartment. Now you will go to the court. It is as good as you giving him credit, 40 lakh credit you gave it to him. You are a creditor, but earlier you were treated as operational creditor, you are not a bank, no. But in the amendment, home buyers are treated as what? Financial creditor. This was in current. This is one thing which you will remember, home buyers. Third, amendment, they said, once you file a case for liquidation, first thing what will happen? See, if there is a lot of insolvency cases which are not resolved, that means there are, this company is collapsing, first thing is NPAs will increase, isn't it? If the companies become insolvent, okay, and you're not using proper liquidation procedure or restructuring it, NPS will increase, which was already a problem. That is why you came up in 2016. Earlier, there are other acts also. For example, you had your Surfacy and other acts which are there. You clubbed all of them to come up with insolvency bankruptcy code. Okay, so because they were inefficient in resolving the companies or insolvency. Now here, NPS will increase. And remember, it is not just the creditor who is going to get affected. It is not just the bank which is getting affected because of this insolvency or this procedure which is not happening, that means improper liquidation procedure, if their NPA is increasing, it is not just the creditor that is getting affected, even the debtor or the borrower is getting affected. Don't you think so? Because banks are getting affected, the companies were not in a position to get loans. Or if at all companies were getting loans, they were getting loans at higher interest. That means it is not just the creditor who is getting affected, but also the borrower or the debtor who is getting affected because of this. And that is the reason in insolvency bankruptcy, even a creditor or a debtor, both of them, any of them can file the case with NCLT. It is not just the creditor. So UPSC comes up with these questions. Under insolvency bankruptcy, it is only the creditor who can file case. No. It can be the creditor who can file for insolvency and resolution, or it can be the debtor or the borrower who can file. So the case can be taken by the debtor or the borrower as well as the creditor for resolution. Very important point. Are you getting this? Not just the creditor, but also the debtor. Any of them. Is this clear, ma'am? Okay. Okay. So then you have insolvency professionals. One more term. And you have insolvency professional agencies. Now see, when the committee of, first of all, within a span of default, on the first day itself, on day one, the creditor or debtor can file a case with NCLT or DBT, DRT. And this case has to be accepted by them within a span of 14 days. The case has to be accepted by them within a span of generally 14 days. Now, once the case is accepted, the lenders are going to appoint a committee of creditors. What kind of creditors are there? They are the financial creditors. Now, this committee of creditors will take the help of insolvency professionals. They are the technical entities. And these insolvency professionals have a lot of experience with respect to this insolvency procedure. Now, these insolvency professionals should have efficiency and integrity. Integrity is the most important thing which these insolvency professionals should have, or ethics. Otherwise, a lot of dilutions can be done. Now, these insolvency professionals will think about a plan for restructuring the loan. Okay. So, these insolvency professionals will be given guidelines or ethical guidelines or instructions from insolvency professional agencies, or you call them as IPA. Why? Some code of conduct has to be followed because it's a critical procedure. So, IPs have to follow a code of conduct. That conduct is given by whom? Insolvency professional agencies. That is the role of IPAs. Okay. Now, once this insolvency professional has been given, this insolvency professional also temporarily can handle the company situation also without dissolving it. The company situation can also be handled by the insolvency professional, that company which is to be liquidated. Now, the procedure generally, they should come up with a restructured plan within a span of how many days? Restructuring plan has to be come up within a span of how many days? 180 days. Under critical circumstances, maybe another 90 days is given. Plan you should come up. 180 day. Another 90 day means how much? 270 days. For the new recent amendment 2018, some preference was given to startups. For startups, the procedure should be completed in 90 days. An additional 45 days in critical circumstances. For startups, but regularly it is how much? 180 plus 90. For startups, it is 90 plus 45. Understood? No, startup. I'll talk about startup later. Modi says start, stand, fly. Not possible with Modi's scheme. I'll tell you how. Okay, so now I think this is clear. 180 days, 90 days for startup. Now, once this in within 180 days, the procedure has to be accepted by the committee of creditors, restructuring plan, and if you're not accepting the restructuring plan, then obviously you have to go ahead with what? Liquidation procedure. Liquidate the company. If the plan is not final, not able to implement it, liquidate the company. Once you liquidate the company, you get the money. First, you will use this money for insolvency procedure. Why? Who will bear the money? Tell me. For this insolvency procedure, you have to give the money. Then you will think of financial creditor. Then you will think of workers in the company. Last, you will think of other operational creditors. Are you getting this? Other operational creditor last because you do not know the relationship between the operational creditor and company. Vijay Mallya, catering facility fellow would have been good friend of Vijay Mallya. He would have said, no problem, let's decide later. Okay, this debt management, we will do it later. I will supply food free of cost for next 3 years. Don't worry. It is very important that I need to be associated with supplying food to Kingfisher Airline. That would have been the deal between the caterer and the Vijay Mallya. So who knows all that? We do not know. And that is the reason we can't see that. He would have promised him, first 2 years, getting an opportunity to supply food in Kingfisher itself is a boon. And therefore, first 2 years, don't give money. If that way they have been there, there will be such deals. Otherwise, big companies, how will you get opportunity? Okay. If such kind of deal would have been there, we will not know. And therefore, operational creditor at the end. Understood. Okay. So, in the recent amendment, what are the changes? Procedure is clear, terms are clear. And you also have information utility centers. Okay. Then one more term, which I forgot. So, terms, one is regulator. Who is the regulator? Bankruptcy board. Okay. Then you have adjudicating authority, NCLT and DRT. You have committee of creditors, mainly the financial creditors. Okay. And you have insolvency professional who has the experience, etc. You have the insolvency professional agency, which will decide the code of conduct for insolvency professional. You have information utility centers because you need to collect the asset liability data information and give it to the insolvency professional. Otherwise, he can't come up with a plan. So that data related to the asset liability, all that information is collected by the information utility centers. And they will give it to the insolvency professional, which will aid the insolvency procedure. Are you getting this point? Now, in the amendments, some things which you should remember is, one important is, one is you know that promoters, okay, or willful defaulters cannot participate in the insolvency procedure, okay. But when it comes to micro, small, medium enterprises, some exception with respect to promoters' participation has been given. Second, earlier, once you file a case under NCLT, it could not be withdrawn later. Earlier, in 2016, once you file a case into NCLT, it could not be withdrawn. Now, the amendment 2018 for your current affair is if you file a case in NCLT, it can be withdrawn with the consent of 90% of the creditors. Are you getting this point? With the consent of 90% of the creditors, this can be withdrawn. Third, some concession for startups. For startup resolution plan, the time period is how much? 90 days. Additionally, how much? Another 45 days. Fourth, home buyers will be treated as financial creditors. That was also there in your amendment. Five, earlier Supreme Court talked about violation of right to equality when financial creditors were distinguished from operational creditors. Now, Supreme Court said it is pretty fine if you can distinguish between an operational creditor and a financial creditor. Is this okay, ma? So, this is about some understanding with respect to... Okay. Fine. Clear, okay. Now simple only, no tension. Next half an hour is like no brain application, but some facts we will see. Okay, so here, is there a difference between a merger and an amalgamation? No, merger is merged. Other, yes. Amalgamation means you'll come up with a new entity altogether. Amalgamation of RRB. Or is it a merger of RRBs? Amalgamation of RRBs. In news, amalgamation of RRB means you are going to come up with new entities. Completely new entity. Are you getting this? Okay. So merger, generally the existing entity exists. Okay, fine. Acquisition, merger is two companies coming together. Acquisition is one company taking completely over another company. That is acquisition. Okay. Put the heading, only bullet points, amalgamation of RRB. Amalgamation of RRB. So that means right now there is the, it is the phase 3 in consultation with NABARD. Okay, RBI has decided for amalgamation of regional rural banks. This is the third phase which is in news. Okay, third phase of amalgamation of RRB. Now, one question here is, RRBs were set up basically during which period? 1975. Okay. Based on Narasimhan Working Group recommendation. Okay. And 1976, basically, you had RRB Act. Based on Regional Rural Banks Act, you came up with establishing regional rural banks. Okay. RRBs, for formation of RRBs, you have three entities coming together. One is the center, another is the state, and you have the sponsor bank. Center, state, and the sponsor bank. Okay. Center, state, and sponsor. Okay. So the ratio for setting up RRB is basically how? 35? Isn't it? I think you have 35 is to 50 is 15 is to 50. This is the ratio. Sponsor bank has 50% weightage. Okay, so this is one thing. Another important aspect which you have to remember, RRBs have to maintain something like your CRR and SLR as the general commercial banks do. But the focus, why did you have RRBs? Means you wanted to cater to the needs of the rural areas, agricultural loans initially. So, and that is the reason you came up with RRBs. Okay. Now, another important aspect is the capital adequacy ratios which RRBs have to maintain. Do they have to maintain capital adequacy ratio? They have to maintain. Okay. And they'll also have to maintain something called as PSL targets. What is PSL? Priority sector lending targets. What is the priority sector lending targets generally? What is the percentage for regular banks? 40%. For RRBs? 75%. So that means if such things are in news, then you should be knowing these aspects. Okay. So you want me to dictate? So one is Narasimhan Working Group 1975. One bullet point. Narasimhan Working Group 1975. Okay. In RRB, ratio of center, state and sponsor bank, 35 is to 15 is to 50. Okay, so that is another point which you will push. Next point, RRBs maintain CRR and SLR, like the regular commercial banks, no tension. Okay, then PSL targets, 75%. PSL target for RRB. Okay. See, RRBs gets funds from several. One is deposits. Second, funds from sponsor bank. Funds from NABARD. It gets funds from SIDBI. Heard of SIDBI? And National Housing Bank. It arranges funds from so many sources. SIDBI, National Housing Bank, okay, the sponsor bank, NABARD, so many sources of funds is there for RRB. Is this clear? Okay, no much of a tension, so you should be knowing that particular aspect. Now, next important area which you should be knowing is, have you heard of something called as payment banks? Heard of payment banks? How are payment banks different from regular banks? Okay, see here, this concept of payment banks was basically suggested by Nachiket Moore Committee on Financial Inclusion. This was his suggestion with respect to a concept of differentiated banking. This was a suggestion with respect to a concept called differentiated banking. Have you heard of differentiated banking? See, differentiated banking means these are the banks, listen, these are the banks which work in certain segments. For example, you come up with payment banks. The purpose of payment bank is basically for financial inclusion. You came up with the concept of wholesale banks. It only operates in a particular segment where you give infrastructure loans or loans to wholesalers, not to the regular retailers. Similarly, you came up with small finance banks. What banks? SFBs, small finance banks, which are going to help maybe in rural areas, etc., smaller credits, etc. Or you have, that means the focus is basically to a particular sections of the population or to the particular demographies in the country. This is called as what? The concept of differentiated banking. So that means you have wholesale banks which give huge loans, generally for wholesalers, infrastructure loans. Or you suggested payment banks for financial inclusion. You came up with the concept of small finance banks where there are certain conditions put forth, like 25% of the small finance banks have to be set up in rural areas. 25% of the banks, small finance banks have to be set up in rural areas. Okay, or you came up with some other concepts. In fact, for example, you came up with mechanisms with respect to sub areas. For example, urban cooperative banks. Heard of urban cooperative banks? So these urban cooperative banks have to be converted into small finance banks. Urban cooperative banks have to be converted into small finance banks. Now this, you have IPPB. What is this IPPB? Indian Post Payment Bank. Indian Post Payment Bank. It is in news because Modi ji has planned this payment bank concept by linking up all the post offices across, and it will act as an entity enhancing financial inclusion. So this particular IPPB is in news, and that is the reason you should also know in and out of payment bank mechanism. So payment bank has emerged out of differentiated banking. Which is the committee which recommended payment bank? Nachiket Moore Committee. Okay. And what is the purpose of payment bank? Do payment banks maintain CRR and SLR? Yes. All banks which are accepting deposits. You're accepting deposits, no? So when you're accepting deposits, some amount of deposits you should push it aside as a form of security. It means you have to maintain CRR and SLR. Are you getting this? But payment banks do not give loans. Payment banks do not give loans. They will push their money into SLR related securities. They are not going to give credit. That means they cannot issue credit card. Simple as that. They are not giving credit means they cannot issue credit card. Already UPSC asked. Payment banks can issue credit card. Wrong statement. Payment banks cannot issue credit card because they can't give loans. Are you getting this point? They cannot issue credit card because it is loan. They cannot give loan. But since they're not giving loans, how do they make profits then? They make profits by investing this deposit money into safe, secured SLR related securities or G-Secs, on which they are going to receive something called as interest. Okay. So put the heading. Is this clear, ma? Understood, I think. Put the heading India Post Payment Bank. India Post Payment Bank. Okay. First September it was launched. Okay. So now just write down some bullet points. Okay. Incorporated under Companies Act 2013. Incorporated under Companies Act 2013. As public limited company, as public limited company with 100% government equity, under Department of Posts, and governed by Reserve Bank, RBI. Understood? No. So it will link up 1.5 lakh post offices, etc. So it will help with respect to building a big network. That is what you'll remember. Next point which you'll write. Very simple points only. There will be a tie-up of different banks, insurance companies, mutual fund houses, for distribution of third-party products. Like insurance, etc. See, in mains, probably you should be knowing that it will be helpful for migrant laborers, unorganized sectors, etc. For prelims, I'm not dictating all those points because it is not as of now required. Okay, so one more point is, it will not offer any ATM debit card. That is one point which you'll remember. No ATM debit card. Instead, QR code biometric card. One more question. Do you think payment banks are scheduled banks? Scheduled commercial bank? They are. Like this only, these are called as traps. Okay, so next put the heading, payment banks. First point, differentiated bank. It is... What ma? Yes, obviously. It's a network. It links all of them. Yes. Okay. So, they should be registered under second schedule of RBI Act 1934. Okay, paid up capital. No. All these banks are scheduled commercial banks only. Today, whatever bank you see outside, no? ICICI, ING, Vysya, you have Kotak. All these are scheduled commercial banks only. Is that clear? Okay. No. It is very... See, first of all, with commercial banks, nothing has happened in terms of financial inclusion. Okay. So, therefore, for financial inclusion, you wanted other things. So, the functions are also different. So, commercial banks have profit motive. And without profit motive, you have to serve. That is the reason you have cooperative banks, developmental banks, etc., etc. And in that process, regional rural banks also help with respect to aiding some rural areas initially, agricultural loans, etc. Okay, so each bank, there is a different function to perform. You can't come up with your own commercial, the same commercial banks cannot do all these functions. They have failed and therefore you have so many things. Otherwise you have so many things, why you have again differentiated banks like payment banks again? That means financial inclusion could not be reached by them and that is the reason you have payment banks. Now Airtel is a payment bank. So that means these entities can become payment banks and they can come up with financial inclusion, extending or accepting deposits, isn't it? Okay, so that is the logic. So, okay, fine, put the heading payment bank, differentiated bank. Next point. Payment banks you are writing. Licensed under Banking Regulation Act 1949. Licensed under Banking Regulation Act 1949. And registered as a public limited company. Registered as a public limited company under Companies Act 2013. And also they are given the status of scheduled bank under RBI Act 1934. They are also given the status of scheduled bank under RBI Act 1934. Payment banks are subject to FEMA. Payment banks are subject to FEMA. Hope you know FEMA. Foreign Exchange Management Act. Comma. Payment and Settlement Systems Act 2007. Payment and Settlement Systems Act 2007. Deposit Insurance and Credit Guarantee Corporation Act. Deposit Insurance and Credit Guarantee Corporation Act 1961. They can accept deposits of up to 1 lakh per customer. They can accept deposits up to 1 lakh per customer. And they have to maintain CRR and SLR. Is this clear? Okay, last point. Unlike the traditional banks, they cannot issue loans. Just scribble. They cannot issue loans. Next point. They cannot issue loans and credit cards. See, I'm not dictating capital conservation buffer, etc., etc., because I explained it enough. Current affair. Only for deposits, ma'am. Only for deposits. And they can, if you want to sell third party products, they can sell if they want. Okay, but no loans. No credit. They will not, suppose Airtel Payment Bank is there. It cannot give loan, but it can accept deposit. People, there is financial inclusion. For people, they can deposit their money. No, they, instead of putting the money in the locker, it is better that you put the money in the bank, they receive interest. Obviously, if they are putting the money in the bank means they will receive interest. Like the regular bank interest, you will also get interest. Understood? Is that clear? No, no. In rural areas, if you have to walk 15 kilometers for getting the bank branch, tell me. It's difficult, no? For financial inclusion. If these banks would have spread so much, then why will they come up with payment banks? It can be offline as well as online, both. Of course, in rural areas, if you come up with online, means obviously you cannot. Is it clear? Okay, chalo. Next, put the heading. Transition of urban cooperative banks into small finance banks. Transition of urban cooperative banks into small finance banks. Now that means the small finance bank concept is also part of what banking? Differentiated banking. That is what you will remember. Differentiated banking. Next, put the heading there only. Small finance banks. Small finance banks. Focus. Put the heading focus. Small farmers, MSMEs and unorganized sectors. Small farmers, MSMEs and unorganized sectors. Okay, mainly semi-urban and rural areas. Mainly semi-urban and rural areas. Okay. Third, minimum paid up capital 100 crores. Minimum paid up capital 100 crores. And capital adequacy ratio 15%. Understood, no? Capital adequacy ratio 15%. Now here, promoters minimum capital should be 40%. Next, out of the total capital, promoters minimum capital should be 40. Slowly they will reduce it. That was the discussion. Okay, so promoters minimum capital, how much? 40. Next, they have to maintain CRR SLR. Just write bullet points. CRR SLR to be maintained. Okay. 75% of their net adjusted net bank credit. 75% adjusted net bank credit. That means 75% PSL target. What is PSL? Priority sector lending. Okay. 75%. Okay. Next, 25% of the 25% of the branches should be in rural areas. Rural areas. And 50% of the loan portfolio, 50% of the loan portfolio should constitute loans up to 25 lakh. Constitute loans up to 25 lakh. Okay. Is this clear? Now, the scheme is what? Converting urban cooperative banks into small finance bank. You should know what is a small finance bank. This is what is small finance bank. Okay. So write down about the scheme. Just bullet points. One line you'll write. Okay. UCBs with minimum net worth of 500 million. UCB with minimum net worth of 500 million rupees. And CAR of 9%. You know that CAR, capital adequacy ratio, CAR of 9% and above are eligible to apply for voluntary transition. Are eligible to apply for voluntary transition. Okay, is that clear? Next. The promoters shall incorporate a public limited company. The promoters shall incorporate a public limited company. The promoters shall incorporate a public limited company under Companies Act. Next, group of individuals having an association with UCB, having an association with UCB for not less than 3 years. Can be treated as promoters after approval of two-third majority. After approval of 2/3 majority, two-third majority. Fine, fine. That's it. Okay. So now that is one area. See, there is this crisis. The crisis is IL&FS crisis. Okay. So I'm not getting into the depth today. So if I have time, tomorrow I will discuss. Okay, so why? Because unnecessarily discussing also, if there is a question, it is fine. Otherwise, it will take a lot of time, the procedure of ILFS. We'll see for mains. Okay, what happened, etc. But it is basically infrastructure loans that were creating problems. That much you should be knowing. And here, a few things which you will remember is, since there is IL and FS crisis, I want you all to put up a heading as NBFC. NBFC, non-bank financial companies. NBFC. So first we'll understand what is NBFC. Because IL and FS is also a NBFC, basically. Okay? So just mention few small points. I think you may be knowing it, but just mention few points. It can engage in business of loans. It can engage in business of loans, acquisition of shares, bonds. Insurance business, chit fund businesses, etc. Insurance business, chit fund business, etc. Okay, next point. I already mentioned this point when I was discussing. I said, next point, second point, it does not include any institution. It does not include any institution whose principal business is that of agriculture activity, comma, industrial activity, comma, purchase of any goods, other than securities. And sale purchase of immovable property, or sale purchase of immovable property. Okay, immovable property. Then next point. NBFCs can be deposit taking and non-deposit taking. Deposit taking and non-deposit taking. So that means deposit-taking NBFCs, they need a compulsory registration of RBI. Deposit-taking NBFCs, they need a compulsory registration of RBI. One more important aspect is, NBFCs do not accept demand deposits. NBFCs do not accept demand deposit. They will only accept what? Time deposits or term deposits. Is this clear? See, NBFCs, can they issue checks? They are not part of your payment and settlement system. Okay, next point. NBFCs are not part of payment and settlement system. Not part. Simple point only. They are not part of payment and settlement system. And cannot issue checks to its customers. Okay, next point. In general, NBFCs need not maintain CRR and SLR. In general, NBFCs need not maintain CRR and SLR. Okay, but deposit-taking NBFCs, are required to maintain at least 15% of its deposits as liquid assets. Have to maintain at least 15% of its deposits as liquid assets. One more important point is, NBFCs can deposit depositors' money in share market. NBFCs can deposit depositors' money in share market. Share market. Share market, unlike banks. Okay, that is one more thing. See, NBFC functions are regulated and supervised by whom? RBI. Okay, that if you do not know, mention that point also. NBFC functions regulated and supervised by Reserve Bank of India. See, shadow banking system means it is basically with respect to NBFC. Okay. Then put the heading, systematically important non-deposit core investment company. Okay, systematically important non-deposit core investment company. Okay, so this was what was your IL and FS group? Infrastructure, leasing and financial services. Infrastructure, leasing and financial services. So CIC NDSI, this was what was your IL and FS, infrastructure, leasing and financial services. It was non-deposit taking NBFC. Okay, systematically important. Now just write down about this CIC NDSI. Why? Because it was in news, no? So therefore, if at all he wants to ask, then if at all a factual question comes up. Just mention some points there. It has an asset size of 100 crores and above. Asset size of 100 crores and above. Two, it holds not less than 90% of its net assets. It holds not less than 90% of its net assets in the form of investment in equity shares, in the form of investments in equity shares, preference shares, comma, bonds, debentures, debt or loans, in group companies. See, group of companies push their money into such NBFCs. In group companies, okay. Next, it accepts public funds. Maybe through mechanism of bonds, etc. If bonds are issued, etc., it can accept public funds, okay. So, shadow banking means, don't get confused, there can be a question on shadow banking or there can be a question on NBFC, okay. So, NBFC reforms after this crisis is basically, even private NBFCs, obviously they have to maintain this capital adequacy ratio of somewhere like 15%. 15% means in liquid assets, okay, they have to maintain. This is extended even to government related NBFCs. It's going to be extended to government related NBFCs after IL and FS crisis. Okay, so that much I think you should be knowing. Okay, sufficient. Okay, so I'll start off from fiscal and financial markets. So let's take a break. How much break you need 1.5 hours? Sufficient. So 2:30, 2:45, 2:45, is it okay? 1:10 is the time now. Is that okay? 2:45. So we can have 3-hour session, or maybe based on your receptivity. So again, we'll assemble tomorrow. Okay, so now I think environment is okay after the ACs are. Okay, so fine. See, one more thing is basically you need to focus on concepts also. Okay, current affairs only an addition. That is why 2 days and later on another 2 days for revision. Okay, and I'm not sure that each and every point am I able to cover, we don't know. But I will see that wherever core concepts are involved, which is difficulty, there is difficulty, I will definitely cover that. But some factual areas, if it is there, okay, so you should be, I think you would have been reading some magazine, etc., and you can manage. I will do my level best in terms of covering, for example, unemployment, agriculture, there are some current affairs, okay, and also there are current affairs with respect to fiscal policy, taxing, okay, and some economic survey and budget related. I'm not going to cover all the schemes. Maybe economy related schemes which are coming up in the budget, I will discuss. All the schemes I will not do. It's not possible also for me. Okay, so that's it. We'll stop here. Okay, we'll continue after the break. 2:45 we will start.